What is up, guys? Welcome to Real Talk, the unedited, unscripted, unfiltered show where I sit down with an eSports personality and talk about anything and everything. Of course, JP McDaniel here. And on this episode, I'm actually joined by someone who basically embodies the very name of this show. I don't really have any idea what's going to come out of this, but regardless, here we go. All right, James, how's it going, man? How you been?
Yeah, good. Yeah. Thanks.
well
done, by the way. I saw the script for the show.
Yeah,
you
I read it perfectly.
It to the T. Yeah,
perfectly.
You read the script.
Well, if you're reading along...
What did you say? Was it unedited, unscripted?
Yes, unscripted, and I followed
but,
the script.
If I go into a Google document, it clearly states... Welcome to The Real Talk, the unedited, unscripted, unfiltered show where I sit down with an eSport personalities and talk about anything and everything. JP McDaniel here, and on this episode, I'm joined by somebody who embodies the very name of the show. I have no idea what will come out of this, but here we go. How's that?
Very good. Well, I can't edit the show, but I guess I can't script it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'd just have you be the intro for this. James, to start off with the show, I am going to follow the script. I'm sorry, guys. But there was a time where I had to kick you off of a show I once did over at MLG. I think we're past this, but I did apologize to you. I was following orders. I was basically at the will of kind of my company, so I apologize for that, man.
So whose orders were they?
Well, since this is Real Talk, it was from the person sitting in the room, Mark Turner, and also Lee Chin.
Oh, Lee.
Well, and I mean, you insulted MLG on an MLG broadcast, man.
Yeah, but sometimes when MLG broadcast themselves, they insult themselves. So.
Isn't that actually what you said on air? Wasn't that word for word? Or no... It was something about Dallas. I forgot what the actual quote was, but...
No, it wasn't. It was the, like, because I had to work with Slasher.
Yeah.
And Slasher, I was like, Slasher, when are we doing mic checks?
Uh-huh.
Don't know. Slasher, when are we going? Don't know. Slasher, are the players ready? Don't know. And then I just got so fed up with it, when the time I came on to cast Quake, I was already in a bad mood.
See, I never heard that side of the story.
And then I was just like, fine, fuck this. Too many problems, gonna make a funny remark, and it was funny. And then MLG, with their amazing PR department, decided to kick me off and cause the Barbara Streisand effect,
yep.
If you're familiar with that. So another, well done MLG PR. How is the MLG PR going these days? Have you hired anybody competent yet? Or
we have.
Are you still letting Sundance just go on his reign
no,
of terror?
No, that's actually gotten better, man. Katie Goldberg is our... head of PR at MLG now. She does a fantastic job.
Yeah? Who's head of Twitter?
Head of Twitter? I don't know who runs that account. I think it's shared by a couple of people. The actual MLG account. Sundance is still free to do whatever he pleases on Twitter. So we can't stop that, unfortunately. We can't stop the madman sometimes. But
can the other guys in the studio hear me? Can Lee Chen hear me?
No, I'm not in New York, man. I'm in my house. No one else is in here.
Oh, you said someone's sitting with you, and what are you looking at?
What?
Who, I don't know, you're not looking
I'm
at
I'm looking
you.
At, yeah, so, all right, full disclosure.
Where am I?
You're right there.
Yeah, I'm on a fucking massive TV in your house.
Yeah, man, I've got a bunch of monitors.
God.
Yeah.
You wearing pants?
No.
I knew it. This is just JP self-porn show, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I heard Whatever. You were actually in the house earlier today not wearing any clothes, according to Apollo.
That was me on his Twitter.
Oh, okay. All right, well, the entire...
I often forget to put clothes on, so... but
as do... It's the best of us. I mean, everyone does that from time to time. But the intro has basically been butchered. Let's just move on. And go from talking to you being naked this morning to talking about your childhood, which I guess there is some relationship.
I was naked a lot in my childhood.
Yeah. I bet. Where were you born, man, and where did you end up growing up?
Okay. I was born in England, in Bristol. There was a problem with my birth. I was too awesome, so my mum had to be... an ambulance had to take her from one hospital to another one, and then I was cut out. What's that called?
C-section?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I was born in Bristol. I was a very quiet baby, believe it or not.
Really?
Didn't make any noise, didn't cry. Yeah, it's the truth. I grew up in Glastonbury. Glastonbury is like the hippie central of England. It's also where like the second biggest music festival is. Glastonbury Festival, second biggest to South by Southwest. And I was always, you know, involved in like, it basically, Glastonbury was shit. It's basically, there's a lot of crystal shops because it's lots of hippies. There's about six reincarnations of King Arthur. And basically, yeah, there seems to be, every time I go home, there's one more crystal shop, as in someone walked down the street and saw, you know, 10 and thought, fuck, I've got a great idea. There's another crystal shop. And so Glastonbury was just a weird, hippie, small town. And when I got internet there, they probably thought I was some sort of wizard, basically. So I was happy to get out of Glastonbury sooner rather than later.
Do you have any brothers and sisters? And if so, what do they do for work?
I have two brothers. I have Will. Will is actually the event manager for Twitch TV. I picked him up for the job because he went to university twice. Have you ever seen the movie Van Wilder?
Yes, yes.
Right, that's my brother, basically.
Nice.
So basically, he went to university for 6 years, got two degrees, sports, exercise, and science, and law. And then while he was at university, he was like president of the university for activities for all the social groups, which basically meant he took a whole year of university getting every student drunk and to make it as fun as possible. So he did that.
Sounds like your brother.
And then afterwards he started up his own like company where he would travel students to like Netherlands and other places from England for like parties and stuff. And he was really good, really organized. And basically we were talking to Own3D and Twitch TV about which one we're going to partner with, me and Trance. And we decided Twitch TV because they actually embodied more of a community like spirit in terms of I wasn't looking for budgets for the team. I was more looking for budgets for the community. And Twitch TV kind of gave me a figure that I could use for community-run tournaments, which has been fantastic so far. And so he was good at getting people drunk and making everyone feel, you know, good and organizing big events with, you know, good promotion. And I asked him if he wanted to try this out, and he has. So he's responsible right now for the DreamHack, for the Twitch TV player lounges that go from DreamHack, Assembly, Intel Extreme Masters. He didn't do the last one, but he'll be doing the next ones. And then, just generally all the events, promotions in Europe. So that's Will. And then Tom is my older brother. Will's my younger. Tom, right now, don't really know what he's doing, I have to say. He's kind of just chilling. But I'm not sure what he wants to do either. He's got like a degree in physics and maths. So he's just like a really nice but also intelligent guy, which I think he got from my dad. And he's, not sure really what he wants to do. So he's just kind of enjoying himself.
What did your parents do for work growing up? And do they still do the same thing now?
No, they didn't do the same thing. They both run their own businesses. Like I don't say entrepreneurs, but maybe my dad was more an entrepreneur. My dad is a structural engineer. Originally, he went to university, got a degree in maths and physics, like my older brother, and he was a self-made millionaire. Actually,
really?
While he was at university.
Wow.
So while he was studying for his degree, he also started up a company. And for his degree at university, he made the flooring in buildings out of steel, and he designed the strongest kind of pattern for steel flooring, and it was used for about 10 years after the design. So he took that, painted it, and then built up a company that was quite big. So he started very young work and continued to do so, and ran his own company. And then my mum was she's a bit of a super mum. I love all my family, by the way. I'm really proud of all of them. So my mum was she was basically looking after us. But when she didn't have to look after us, she ended up running her own company, where she would travel world music bands across Europe and England. So she would bring over like African bands and stuff like that, you know, and tour them around Europe and England while she was still studying at university to get her degree, because she didn't get her degree when she had us as kids. And she did that, and she did lots of other jobs as well. But now she runs, she's like one of the managers at Glastonbury Festival, and she's also involved in different festivals around England and stuff. So she books, she's really fun, because she tells me stuff like, she's like, yeah, you know, we booked Stevie Wonder, you know, for this. And there's like, how much does Stevie Wonder cost? And she's like, oh, she's like, it's like 800,000. I'm like, fuck, what the hell? Yeah. So she has a really fun life, and she's doing great. Yeah, and I also get to see her, because she makes time for us. She comes over and helps at the Twitch booths.
That's awesome.
In Europe. So she just comes over and does a little bit of hostessing, just so she can see me and Will, because we don't have a lot of time between all three of us to actually meet each other.
So your dad's a self-made millionaire. Your mom basically works with some of the best musical groups around the world, and you work in eSports. Are they happy with your career path? Do they support you fully with it? What are their thoughts on it?
Yeah, they are. When I was younger, my mum used to walk past, because I knew I was going to be in eSports from the very get-go, because it was something I was much more passionate about. And when my mum used to walk past my bedroom door when I used to live with her, she used to be like, you're never going to get a job playing video games. And that was her, you know, kind of thing. And then eventually, you know, it ended up working out for me, just through, you know, a little bit of dedication and just, you know, following what I wanted to do in life. My dad isn't a millionaire anymore. Unfortunately, the recession stopped that. So, yeah, he's... but both of them actually really support what I do. They watch the shows that I do here at the Good Studio. They follow, you know, some of the live events. And my dad's probably been following me for the longest. He was following me all the way back in Fnatic in 2004. And he actually had accounts on all the different websites where... Because after the recession, when the whole company went down, his company, he ended up just being a tax man, which was quite fitting for my father, because someone who's fantastic at avoiding taxes, he used to buy houses in cash under like his sister's name and stuff to avoid
Jesus
things. Yeah. And but yeah, it was a cool, I mean like, you know, the whole self-made millionaire with my father within his own company. It wasn't like, when you say self-made, it's more like, okay, his company's worth X amount, whether or not he had that like in his pocket, you know. But it was more like, growing up was quite fun, because I did get every video game I wanted. And they were really happy to buy me video games, because they were just like, you buy Jay a video game, he's happy, you know. The other two brothers want to run around and do this crazy stuff. Like, Jay just wants to play video games. So, yeah, we had a huge collection of video games, to the point where we lived in quite a small village before we moved into Glastonbury. And we used to have all the kids over for, like, Street Fighter tournaments. And,
nice.
And then we used to sell all the games off to them for different price tiers, depending on the game was. So, like, Mario would be, like, £15. And then something shit would be a fiver. But yeah, it was cool. But they're really supportive of what we do. Yeah. And they're really impressed, actually, because my mum works in the event industry, and she sees a lot of potential within eSports, you know, in terms of the audience size and, you know, how to optimize it. So, you know, when she comes to an event, she always gives me some ideas of, you know, and, you know, just like, you know, says that this is good and stuff. And yeah.
Did you enjoy school growing up? Did you get good grades? Your brothers seemed pretty well educated. What about yourself?
Yeah, I think I'm the least smartest out of all my brothers. Like, but yeah, because my dad was like, dad's definitely overly intelligent. And I think my brother's definitely got a bit of that, which basically means they're going to have the first nervous breakdown. So I'm winning, as far as I can tell. School was really fun. Yeah, I mean, I never disliked doing anything, really, in life. I always try and get the best out of every situation. At school, my grades, I got addicted to video games, internet video games at school. So when I first turned up, I was kind of an A-B student in terms of the amount. It's not about how intelligent you are at school. I would love to go back to my school and tell kids like what life's about. Because yeah. It's like, I turned up, I was very dedicated, and I was putting over amount of time into homework, in the first year and a half. And I was like, an A-B student. And then I found online games. I didn't find them so much by choice, actually. There was a story behind this, but I don't know how deep we want to go into my life. But basically, when I found online video games, I basically would play until 4 o'clock in the morning on a PC. And to do so, I would have to like run the internet cable outside my front window into the lounge window and then into the 56K modem while my mum was asleep. And I used to play until 4 in the morning, and then basically I decided that I would finish school and I would aim for all C's, because I didn't see the point of trying to get a B or an A when I considered no one would give a shit in future life what you did at school. And I looked at the, and because my brother was older and I, knew some older guys, and they were telling me about college and stuff, and they're like, yeah, they only care about if you get math and English, because if you don't get math and English to a level C, and our college is your high school, basically they might make you do an extra course while you study. So basically, yeah, I played a lot of video games, played a lot of sports, and went for C's, and I finished with straight C's, 2 D's, and 2 B's. So I think that's right, yeah. So the D's are in like German and something shit.
In terms of the social aspects of school, were you? I kind of envision you to be the class clown somewhat. Is that true?
No, I mean actually, I was a lot quieter at school. I was much more an observer of life rather than a partaker, if you can call it that. It was more of the sense that when I went to school, I fit into every different social group, so I was able to hang out with the skaters and whatever. The only social group I really hated was people who played football, because I just felt there was, like, I don't know, it just felt weird to me. I was just like, oh, so you like this kid the most because he's good at football. So I basically hung around with anybody, but my favorite group of friends, the true group of friends, were the more nerdy group, where basically, they would have like computer game magazines and, they'd be building PCs. It was just because, like, out of all the people at school, I just felt like they were the most honest.
Right.
And they would tell you, what they think and there's always one really hot girl in the nerdy group of girls. That was good too.
Is that the one that friend zones all the nerds? Is that the one you're talking about?
No, but there's always one. But I remember like walking around school and I'd be like, oh, I'm going to go up and hang with, these couple of guys. And I'd be walking with a couple of the group friends from the kind of computer-y in a group. And they'd be like, oh, okay. And they just, wouldn't want to come with me. And I was like, and then if I walked up with them, some of like the skaters or whatever they were, they're like, why are you hanging around with these guys? So it was a bit weird that the social groups of school, but I enjoyed it. And I just, yeah, was myself. So it was fun. But I was a lot quieter, but I had a really dangerous mouth on me in terms of, I mean, I think I remember being able to make people cry just from verbally insulting. So I wasn't that. I thought it was funny, but I think I upset a lot of people. So after school, I remember some girls throwing chairs at me.
Ouch! Ouch! Yeah. You mentioned your hatred for the soccer/football players. Did you happen to play any sports at all yourself?
Yeah, I was in all the sports teams. I think people always remember their sporting career in their life better than it actually was.
Yeah,
you know,
of course.
Whenever someone tells me about their sporting career, I always take it with a pinch of salt. So I'll be as honest as possible. Basically, I was the best sportsman in the world. I ran the 100 meters in 5 seconds flat. And I played every sport. I was in all the teams. I was in all the teams at school. I was in all the teams at high school, to call it yours. And I was in 3 teams at college. And yeah, sport was actually what triggered me getting into eSports, in a sense. It was the mentality. Because, you know, I used to play everything. I was even on the football team, even though I didn't like the football team that much. But I used to play because I just like playing sport. But basically, yeah, through school, you know, I actually have records for setting times still at school for the 400s for somehow. I actually remember going back there and still seeing my name. But I played everything. I think, you know, I was good. I enjoyed it, and that's the most important thing. But actually, I ended up at the age of, I think it was 13 or 14. This is what got me into eSports. Was I was playing a lot of sport, and I was playing a lot of console, and I didn't really have a PC, and I didn't have the money to get a PC, because this was, you know, my parents divorced. So, you know, it wasn't like when I was a tiny little kid when, you know, I could have what I wanted, and I was very young when that happened, so it didn't really affect me to grow up. I definitely didn't grow up spoiled or anything. I just, you know, I was like, oh, we've got a nice house and a swimming pool and, you know, whatever. But it didn't really affect me. Just, you know, it was like this. So where by the time actually, like, parents got divorced and after the recession, you know, there was really not much money in the house, because my mum had gone from looking after the kids to, and before she did all this world touring, when she was studying, she was working at like a gas station to get money. So she was doing like 3 jobs in turn. So it was quite normal growing up then, which was great, because it really taught me the value of money. Mm-hmm. In a sense of what it's like to have none. So when I was doing sports, I actually got a problem with my knees. And I remember I was in the, I used to play badminton for the county, which is pretty much like, there's 30 or so counties in England. So it's like representing one of your counties in badminton. So I was number one seed for the county, and I used to train with Southwest England team. But didn't make the squad because I was training a year before my age group. They used to let me in. But then as I was running around the badminton courts, I just got this massive pain in my knees when I was warming up for badminton. And I used to do sports 5 times a week, and my poor mum would have to drive me everywhere. And then I just remember having to stop, and I started like crying, and my knees hurt so much. And anyway, long story short, I ended up not being able to walk for about a year and a half, Jesus. I think it was. I couldn't bend my knees, basically. And so I could walk like a penguin, which is awesome. I got to leave my lessons early, 5 minutes early, which was made me a very popular person in French and German, because I used to be able to take someone with me to make sure I could get up and down the stairs. Ooh. And I couldn't bend my knees, and so I couldn't do any sports. And so my grandparents, who were like, everyone loves my grandparents, I love them as well, they're like some of the best people in the world. I had really lucky to have such a good family. My grandparents took some money that they'd been saving for us for like, you know, college funds, you could call it. And basically they took the money out and they bought me a computer. So I had my mates, you know, they were much better at me at building computers and deciding. So we bought like a Pentium 2 and top of the range, everything at the time. And I'd already been exposed to PC gaming around their houses. And so I got my own computer, and basically, very quickly, I found just online leagues and ladders in the games that I was playing. And basically, I, you know, from what I enjoyed doing in sport, I basically took into video games, which is competition. But I just found it so much easier to connect, to get that stimulation that you get from sports competing with somebody. You know, it really, yeah. It gave... It was instant. You didn't have to get changed or have the right, you know, so much of the right equipment or the right time of the club to start playing. You could literally jump on and compete against other people. So, yeah, I mean, sports was very apparent to me a big part of my life. But then, you know, I was never going to be like, you know, like world champion or anything. But, you know, it was nice to be able to, when that incident happened, to be able to take that kind of what I've learned over the years of just trying to be good at sports and enjoying it into video games.
Do you think if that the incident with your knees hadn't have happened, that you probably that would have been kind of a different turning point in your life? Or would you have still gone on to play everything that you played?
I definitely think it would have. I think it was more of a turning point because I played a lot of video games, like a ridiculous amount, but I wasn't looking for anything hardcore in the sense of, you know, hardcore is in what eSports is.
Right.
I wasn't really looking for it because I already had sports which supplemented my need for, you know, like exercise as well as competition and, you know, just, you know, as a guy, you always have to kind of, you know, prove yourself to a certain level in some things you do in life. You
right.
know, most of us now, when you get a bit older, it's more business, you know, on a professional competition level. And so I think, you know, it was an unfortunate time, but I think it really, you know, found and gave me something. And one of the things I got from it, much more so, was the social side of being able to connect with so many different people and actually make friends over, you know, the game and the internet. And it was something that I just felt was so, to me, was really powerful in the fact that it just felt so good. You know, I really did enjoy logging in, and I kind of felt like, you know, a lot of my friends that I really liked back in school days and, you know, some kids that grow up and don't want to be football stars and don't want to be the most popular kid. I just felt that eSports, when I found it, would be able to pave way for, you know, younger versions of us to be able to find what we do and actually be like, I want to be this rather than I want to be a football star or I want to be a, you know, page free model or whatever the fuck kids want to do. And so the reason that I probably stayed so passionate towards eSports was because the experience that it gave me over those couple of years as well as everything afterwards. And I just want to see if I can offer it to more people by building awareness. So it was a big point.
You mentioned university or college for us here in the States. Where did you attend and did you graduate? If so, with what degrees?
I did high school first, art, ICT, physical education, and sports exercise and science. And I dropped out of that because I was like, it's kind of boring. So I just did ICT, computer shit. I did that. Then I moved on to college and I did, went to the University of Gloucestershire and I did, systems analyst with something else. I think it was, I changed it once. And basically, I only went to university because I didn't know what I wanted to do. And I wasn't a pro gamer by then. I knew I wanted to play games professionally, but I'd been like Quake 3 gaming, you know, TDM, and, you know, and I'd been to like all these LANs and stuff and met, you know, Blokey and Dallow and, you know, big figures within the gaming industry in England that were creating LANs and also winning LANs to talk about those two in particular. And when I went to university, I just did it because I just wanted the experience. I wanted to live away from home. I wanted to waste taxpayers' money. And basically, I just turned up to university, had a really good time, went out with a lot of really nice friends. And my systems analyst course was really simple and easy, I felt. So I didn't try that hard. And basically did the first year. And then during the second year, I was like, yeah, kind of bored of this. I'm, you know, going to be a Quake 4 professional. So I basically decided that I'd stop it. I got earmarked to have a job as a systems analyst for a company, so I thought I'd try this. I only really chose systems analyst to make money because I didn't know what I was wanting to do, and it was problem solving in terms of what it did. So I took a job for 6 months, was really bored. At the work, I was sat at my job as a junior systems analyst, and I would calculate how much money I would earn on an hourly basis, and I would go on to eBay. And I would try and buy something for every hour for the correct amount of money that I was getting paid while at the job. I did all the work. It was like super easy. It was like really, but it was really fucking boring. And I just realized that all these people that are in charge of this company were making a shit ton of money. And the people that were making them a shit ton of money were like the guys, like, in the work was us. And I when I spoke to them, I realized the only reason they're making a shit ton of money compared to all the other guys is because they're good at talking. Right? I was like, they're good at talking, but they're not that good at talking. And all they're doing is the business deals and bringing in the opportunities. I was like, I'm not going to sit here and make these guys a shit ton of money because I feel like a monkey. The work's got boring now after 6 months. And I was like, and Quake 4 hadn't come out yet. So I was still, you know, waiting for something to happen in terms of like esports. And so I decided I could talk better than them. I could probably do business better than them because they were country bumpkins and I didn't want to work for them. So I quit the job. And then I went to work for Sony as a salesman, which was a fantastic job because it taught me how to approach a lot of different people in terms of just, you know, socially interacting with other people than your peers.
Right.
And then during that job, Quake 4 came out, and then I instantly quit and went to Elan, joined Team Dignitas, and started from there. But university, I didn't get my degree, and I really don't care to. I mean, if I was to say to anybody about university, I was like, you can go, but you'll get more out of it than a degree, because degrees are overrated these days. You get much more in life for dedication and finding something you love doing. So,
absolutely.
I pretty much learned how to pick up girls, drink a lot of alcohol, and, you know, and...
Still important life skills, though, so at least it taught you something.
Yeah. But we don't get into debt over here than you do in America.
Yeah. Well, lucky you guys, because I'll be paying that for a long, long time, sadly.
I left the country.
What was your favorite childhood memory, if you can think or figure out a singular memory from your childhood?
That's weird.
This is the question that everyone has a hard time asking.
Well, I know what it is.
Oh.
Like, I remember it, but I think it's weird. It's the first time I had a threesome at the age... No. I remember it, and actually, it was... I was at primary school, and it stuck with me, this childhood memory. And it wasn't... It was basically... I had a couple of... My mum obviously had her own social group, and she had a friend who had some older boys. And we used to go there every Christmas and hang out with them. And basically, these older boys had one of these, what were they called? The things that have the two, you got two sticks and a bit of string, and then there's two cylinders that connect, and you go, and then you throw it up and you do tricks.
Oh, I don't know what those are called, but I know exactly what you're talking about. They don't even have a name. It was just like a child's plaything.
Oh, they have names.
I don't remember. Here, you keep talking.
It's called, something with a G.
You keep talking, I'll Google.
So basically, I'd imagine schools have their own phases of cool things, and obviously their school did. So when we went round to see them, they had one. And basically, they were showing me how to throw it really high, and like really fucking high, and then catch it. And I was like, oh, okay, this is fun. So I started playing with it, and then I got my mum to buy me one. Anyway, I went to my school. And I decided I was at primary school, so it's under the age of 11, so I would have been like 9 or something. And I took it into the playground, and there's different playgrounds. There's a small playground, large playground, and then there's a green. And there's only about 20 people in each class, and there's only about 5 to 6 classes during the whole school. Yeah, something like that. So it's a really small school, maybe 150 people tops, to be honest. And I took it into a small playground, and no one had seen these before. And I started playing with it. And then everyone was like watching me. I was like, hello. I was like, look at me with my... Is it a Diablo? No.
To be honest, I searched for funnel thing with strings, and it came up with cephalopod. So.
We've got one in the house. 1 second. Fuck this interview.
All right. Let's wait for it. Let's wait for it. I don't know if I should throw up an intermission sign. We'll just let it happen. You can actually see a little bit of the house there. Never actually seen that before. So actually coming up, we'll be talking about the competitive career, getting into that, talking about his casting. And we'll also, towards the end, kind of just have a free talk. The Day 9 stuff will definitely come up. Some casting stuff will come up. the Good Studio, kind of his time as a dev. A lot more stuff, actually, still in this interview. So here he is.
See? Fucking.
I think it's called a dabbler.
Do you want to do it for us right now? Can you?
No, because I have to throw it. I didn't know. All right, I'll tell you the end of the story.
Okay.
Basically, I took it into the playground, and lots of kids started gathering around me and watching me. Then I started throwing it up and down, you know, in terms. And more people came, and I was like the center of attention. And you're not normally a center of attention as a kid, and it was the first time for me to be center of attention. And basically, I was just throwing it like higher and higher, as high as I could, and all the crowd, the kids, were just chanting, higher, higher. And I was just like, okay. I was like, and I throw it as high as I can. And one of the teachers came out and then told me to stop. So I threw it up one last time, because I always do that after a teacher tells you to stop, because it pisses them off. Like, stop doing that with your pencil, and then you do it once more when they walk away. So I threw it one last time, and then tried, you know, caught it behind my back, which obviously didn't continue it spinning, but whatever. And after I was done, a girl from my year came up to me and was like, I was like, oh, my sister wants to say something to you. And, you know, I knew the girl, Katie, and then her little sister I didn't know. And she just, like, told me, like, thanks, or, you know, well done, or, like, you know, something, and then wanted to give me a hug. And I was like, wow, this Diablo shit's a chick magnet. But it was really cool. It was really cool to have, like, so many people appreciate, like, something, and you being something. It was like being good at something and having people enjoy what you do. And it was the first time you experienced that, because you're very young. No one really enjoys what you do when you're 9 years old, because all you do is fucking trash your dad's car or make, you know, make a mess in that. And do things you're not meant to do. So I'm quite ADHD, so I was bored of the Diablo after that instance. And every day I used to walk to school, there were more and more Diablos. And then kids used to stop me as I walked past and be like, hey, Jay, look at this. I can do around the world, and then do the thing around their leg. And I'm like, right. I'm going over there now to play football and put rocks down Sarah's back because I fancy her. It was weird, but it was really fun experience. And I remember it even today. So it was a very young memory, but it was very enjoyable. And I guess, you know, it kind of taught me I maybe enjoy entertaining or doing things that people appreciate.
Right. Haven't asked any of the other guests this, but I feel it's only proper. What was the first alcoholic beverage you ever had, and how old were you? If you can remember.
I remember drinking a lot of vodka, like a lot of vodka, from probably the age of, I don't know, 13, 14. Maybe 15, but I didn't drink a lot. But like, we used to have parties, and it was very easy to drink vodka with like a mixer, as opposed to the other drinks. It was very clear tasting. So I wasn't half as bad as my other brothers. My other brothers were, they would throw house parties all the time, which was great for me, because I used to just come down and be like, hey girls, I'm his older brother. it was like vodka, but it was probably before that. I used to drink gin and tonic when I was around 11 or 12, because my granddad loved gin and tonic. It was his favorite drink, and he was never scared of letting me have one, you know, at lunch or something when we used to go around once a week. So, but yeah, gin and tonic, I guess.
It's a funny story, actually. So you actually were the reason, you and Joe Miller at WSVG Louisville, Kentucky in 2007, 2008, something like that. I had, in my family, we had alcoholism kind of run through the family a bunch of parts. So I stayed away from drinking because I knew that in my blood I was eventually going to become an alcoholic one way or the other. So here I am, just turned 21, show up to the WSVG event, just signed with them. And you and Joe were drinking in the hall just straight from a bottle. And I come up to you two and you hand me the bottle. I'm like, well, I guess it's going to start somewhere. So then that night turned into a huge night of drinking the first night, and it ended with Joe under the bed smoking a cigar, or a cigarette, so.
Under the bed?
Yeah, do you remember that?
Sitting. No, I don't.
That was fun times, man. Sitting.
Joe's crazy.
Joe, is he still that crazy, by the way? I haven't seen him in a long, long time.
Joe's always crazy, man. He's way more crazy than me.
Good.
The thing is like me and Joe, like on camera, and what people's perception is I'm the crazy one. Because on camera, I'm the crazier than Joe, and he's straighter. But outside the camera, when we go to the events, Joe is he's the best, man. He will tear shit up.
He will.
He's so much fucking fun. But yeah, no, sorry about that for introducing the alcohol.
It's all good,
alcohol
man. It's all good. It's all
but it's something to worry about, though, because I think that, like, drugs and alcohol affect people differently.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
And I think if you have people in your family that have been affected, you know, in a non-normal way through, you know, taking drugs or alcohol, you have to be a little bit careful, be like, so my dad's like that.
Yeah.
After doing this, maybe I'll just stay away from that one.
It was it was funny this morning when we were scheduled to do it at 9 a.m. for me, and I was thinking, should I have a drink at 9 a.m.? I kind of feel like it's appropriate. I might as well. And then he didn't show up, so.
I was I got home. I was out last night partying. I got home at 12.
Nice.
Midday. So I went to bed for 4 hours.
Gotcha. Well, that's your childhood. Let's move on to your competitive career, which I think it's kind of interesting. A lot of your newer fans might not even know this about you, but were you always competitive just to get into this with games, with your friends, family? Were you always trying to be the best?
Yeah. I mean, even from what I mentioned, you know, we used to have Street Fighter tournaments at the house when the first Street Fighter came out. And we used to, you know, Mario Kart, GoldenEye later and all that other stuff. So we always did competitive things. Having two brothers was really good fun, you know, to be able to compete with each other. Competitive career, you want to know, I don't know, where it started?
Yeah, what was the first time that you received money for playing a game? And what was it for? Was it Quake?
Was it before money.
The first time that you were basically, you either won, whether it was a tournament among friends or anything like that.
I mean, yeah, we won money when we were younger, and I won money at internet cafes, you know, for like Quake 2 and Half-Life Deathmatch, and, you know, used to go down to internet cafes, which was fun, because I didn't have a PC. But the first real time I won money was probably quite late. I mean, I don't really remember winning anything in Quake 3 other than... I think I won, like, PC equipment in Quake 3, but I don't think I might have won like €100, you know, like, and this was back when, you know, really soon after Quake 3 launched, you know, I played, I was a TDM player, because I didn't really enjoy playing Duel. It was quite a solo experience, and it was a little bit boring, you know. It's much more fun to play team games, so I used to play TDM, and I went to the tournament, and I just decided, well, fuck it, I'll enter the Rocket Arena 3 1v1 tournament.
Rocket Arena 3.
Yeah, man. I mean, it was just basically, it's basically, you start at the beginning of the map, you got like 200 health, 100 armor.
That's what I played in Quake, just, man. That was the only mod. I never played DM, and I hated myself for it afterwards.
Yeah, but it was, but like you needed the sickest LG aim, railgun shots had to hit everything, rocket shots couldn't miss, because if you miss one rocket, he'd kill you with LG.
Yep.
Basically, I entered that tournament just for a laugh, and I ended up winning it, like beating out all the players. And I was really, I think when you're younger, you respond, or you focus more on not the meta of the game, but more the, you know, the small intricacies, in the sense that you're focused on skill.
Right.
Rather skill within playing, rather than maybe, you know, the broader picture in terms of the more intellectual side of things, which are, you know, the correct decision making.
Right.
And I think as a younger gamer, I was more run and gun kind of, you know, skill based. And I thought of myself that way because I came from sport, which I thought I was also quite good at. So I kind of took that mentality in. So I won money there in RA3 at a Savlan, as well as a PC case. And then just carried on with a bit of Quake 3 team deathmatch. And then, as I mentioned, this is while I was all going to university. And then I didn't really win money again until Quake 4 came out. And I decided I'd go pro with it. And that was like 2004, I guess, something around there. Late 2004, November 2004. And then during 2005, 2006, I won money. Like, you know, like a not an average salary, like a lower salary, like 24,000 a year would be my yearly income from playing games.
Before I want to talk about kind of the peak of it, but I got to ask, what was it like playing competitive World of Warcraft?
Actually, the game was fucking good when it came out, man. Like, there was no game like that. You logged on.
I mean, you know my history with it, so preaching to the choir here.
I mean, the idea of competitive World of Warcraft is I played a shit ton of World of Warcraft, and I really enjoyed it. I was the raid leader. I was the PvP battleground leader, if you can call it that. He did all the tactics. I used to sit outside of Orgrimmar and I used to duel anybody, and I would win, 99% of the time. And, to be good at that game, you did need a lot of time, but there were so many mistakes that could be made during a fight that you really had to define yourself.
Right.
It wasn't a skill set like Quake or Counter-Strike in terms of that aim and skill base. It was more like, that Dota is having constant knowledge and having the constant, correct positioning, and also knowing every ability that you're pressing out of your 80 abilities is correct, even though some of them were obviously, more obvious than others. So I decided that I wanted to try World of Warcraft professionally, and I got Vu and Strider in, who are Quake and also Painkiller professionals.
So crazy.
Yeah, and basically Vu was absolutely fucking dog shit. And I had to teach him how to play the game in about a week, and he hadn't played mage before, and I came up with the composition of warrior, mage, paladin, and Strider was actually really, really fucking good at paladin. And we went to WSBG China, and Vu is like, he was really shit, and then when he got to WSBG China, he was just so good as a competitor, like cooling everything and just being like a really good competitor. It's completely different to what we had in practice. And we went up, and there was Pandemic there. There was Mob Gaming,
Mob Gaming, holy shit.
Yeah. And there was, like, V-Hell, who now works in Blizzard, was there. Yeah. Kint, who did some commentary later.
Yep.
Azel wasn't there, but he now does commentary in StarCraft 2. There was also Nocturne, who now works for Blizzard in QA. He was at that tournament.
Natrana as well. Or Natrana wasn't there, right?
Yeah. And Malice was there.
That's right. He was the mage,
And luckily for us, we looked really good, because I think we were actually quite shit. But luckily for us, basically, the Chinese didn't get the latest patch or version.
They didn't have Burning Crusade, which just came out.
So basically, they were like doing things that they hadn't done before, like going invisible on their mages and freaking the fuck out. And we were like, oh my god. So we were guaranteed basically a top three spot. But it was really good still, though, because Pandemic were definitely better than us across the board in terms of just because their mage against our mage, even though I think I was way better than their warrior, Nocturne. And then basically we ended up almost beating them just because they were so fucking nervous. It was unbelievable. And Vu was just like ice cold killer, man. He was just like, he didn't even need to know what buttons he was pressing. He was just slamming faces. And we almost beat him, and they took us by one round. And then by the time we got to the finals, we played them again. They were a lot more calm, and then they beat us, just skill-based. But we played the finals on 600 ping. So World of Warcraft is an eSport. I enjoyed it. It went downhill shortly afterwards for me, but I enjoyed commentating it a lot. But in general, as an eSport compared to other eSports, it's definitely not there.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it reached so many different people, and I'm actually still most famous today in terms of like what I've done is people saying, oh, I used to remember you from World of Warcraft, because the stream figures were so much bigger. So I think World of Warcraft esports was a great thing overall, because it brought a lot of people, into the scene.
Yeah.
So I was happy that I was there doing it, because it was a lot of fun. Yeah.
What was the peak of your competitive career in your estimation? The singular moment that you were at the highest of highs in your career?
I think at QuakeCon, for Quake 4, QuakeCon 2000 and blah, I don't know. But basically, I never used to train that much in Quake 4. I don't regret it, but I always used to train like, I was really bad. I used to train like 4 hours a day and then go see my girlfriend and go down the pub.
It's better than some StarCraft players, man. So
Well, I sound bad for someone who's meant to be, you know, embody a lot of esports, but I trained a lot at the beginning. That was why. I trained like a shit ton at the beginning, and I got really good, and I came third at DreamHack, just behind Toxic and Fox, you know, and I started off really strong, and then I kind of let myself go because the challenge of winning a video game over and over wasn't as inspiring to me later on as it was at the beginning. And I was kind of looking for something else, and which is why I transitioned over to like the business side, because I didn't really know anything about business, but I knew what the community would have wanted and what people were doing right and wrong. And I felt like I was a better consultant for a lot of other companies that worked, you know, for Fnatic, worked with Fnatic when I was actually at Fnatic in terms of helping them. So basically, the peak of my career when I was probably the best was actually at QuakeCon, and I played Sturmy in the 1v1 tournament and beat him. Quite convincingly, and then I finished 6th, which is quite good for QuakeCon, because that was, you know, everyone was there, and Quake 4 was real big, so Fatality was there, you know, he got like 16th or something. I didn't even have to play him in the tournament, and then, you know, to beat Sturmy and just, you know, come, you know, I lost to Cypher, who got 5th. That was really good. And then also, I was really good at team deathmatch, a lot better than I was at duel. I only did dueling because I knew it was the only way to take me to like an international stage. Mm-hmm. So I had TDM, and I played with Blue from All Stars, and we came 2nd, only to Toxic and Strider, and we beat Cooler and Jibo. You know, I don't even think we had to play Fatality and Sturmy because they weren't up there. But yeah, we did really well, and we beat a lot of good teams, and it was really fun beating Cooler and Jibo. Yeah, that was really fun.
So after Quake 4 kind of, well, no, you were actually still casting it when it was a big thing, when Toxic went on his run. What was the first time you casted a game? Was it Quake? Who did you cast for? What tournament was it for? And how did that opportunity come up?
So the first time I tried casting was I was a big fan of Clanbase, which is now owned by GGL. But back in the day, Clanbase was the Premier League for pretty much everything esports. You know, they had volunteer admins, great little system. And I decided they were asking for a caster for a TDM game between, like, Germany and somebody. And I decided I'd cast it. So I used to have to do the thing. And this was, you know, way back in the day, like, around 2002 mark or something. And I you know, loaded up Shoutcraft, which was an add-on. To win up that would allow
Shoutcast.
You to
don't get Shoutcast, total best get
yeah.
any love.
Yeah, sorry. Shoutcast, which is an add-on for Winamp, where you basically had to join the game through GTV, which was a client, so you could watch the game, and then you would have to start your Shoutcast. You could play your music from Winamp on there, and also you could talk into your microphone. And so it was really simple to use, and it was great. But the only problem is the people on the other end had to sync up your own voice with what's going on in game. But Quake 3 at the time had a timer, and you'd be able to like say, hey, guys, the time is now, you know, 1 minute, 10, 11, 12, and then they would pause you at 12 and wait for the game to catch up and hit play, and they'd be synced. So I did a game between Germany and someone else, and I just remember I only had like 20 to 40 people listening, which was actually quite a lot, I think, back then. And especially for someone who no one heard of, apart from I was a player for DC, UNR, and all that other stuff. And basically, I just made lots of jokes about the Germans. just not about Germans, but just about their play style. And but I had good insight to the game. And people actually messaged me afterwards saying, you know, great job, I really enjoyed it and stuff. So I did that way back then. And then I was like, you know, wasn't my thing, you know. DJ Wheat was doing his Quake tournaments, you know, he was casting some stuff I was in later as well, and I just kind of left it, and I was like, you know, I enjoy playing. And then I went to WSVG 2006,
something like that.
Yeah, the finals where Toxic beat out Fatality, and basically it was being run by ITG, I think it is.
I want to say yes. I think you were correct.
And basically, Joe Miller was there. He was one of the main commentators. And what happened was, Joe Miller and his, I think it was Brent, were on the main stage because it was kind of really high production televised. And they were on the main stage, and their game was delayed. So they called in Corey Dunn. Corey Dunn was a Counter-Strike right. commentator.
Yeah.
And Corey Dunn was sat down at the desk, and he was meant to cast Cooler versus someone else. And basically, I was looking at this and going, oh God, that's, you know, Corey Dunn's a great commentator, but he needs someone with him. And so basically I said, Corey, you know, let me sit down with you and do this game because, you know, Joe's meant to be here, but he can't move set. And I was like, you know, I'll do it. And Corey leant back to Hunter, who was, you know, off stage. And they said, he goes, Hunter, he's like, Hunter, can I bring on a guest commentator, you know, someone to help me out? And he's like, and Hunter was like, nah, man, you know, like kind of shaking his head. And he goes, well, who is it? And then I just go, it's me. And Hunter liked me a lot. Hunter was awesome because he actually was involved, I don't know if you knew this, with Twisted Metal.
Yeah.
He worked on Twisted Metal. He was actually one of the profile pictures. I think he was Warthog.
I think so. He was pretty high up on that game, too. Yeah. He wasn't, like, a ground-level guy.
Yeah. He's fucking awesome, Hunter. And so Hunter just saw me and was like, yeah, sure, boom, get him on. And me and Corey did this cast, and I made so many mistakes. I called Mega Health Mega Armor. And on ES Reality, they took my face and put me in Knight Armor and called it Mega Armor. But they loved it. It was, like, funny mistakes, but I had really good insight, and I really enjoyed it. I eventually transitioned over more to commentary because I kind of felt like if I want the scene to grow, esports to grow, I need to do the job which offers the most to the industry.
Right.
And I felt me as a player, if I'm not winning tournaments, I'm not in the spotlight, you know, and I do a couple of interviews here and there, I'm actually quite a, you know, a small figure within esports in terms of I'm not helping esports, I'm only helping myself. You know what I mean? So I decided if I go into commentary, with having a professional background in, you know, Quake and also World of Warcraft, I would be able to bring potentially the best commentary to the game that even that hopefully new people would be able to enjoy it, you know, later on when they learn more and also find that the passion I bring is also there. And I was always trying to, when I commentate, was always trying to tell the story of the players, the teams, and also, you know, give people more of an example, not just of what's going on in game, but who the person is, you know, like what the story is, how much they want to win this or what their preparations mean. Because even though esports is it's a great industry, I still think that much more interesting at the game itself is the people playing the game. And I feel that a lot of commentators right now, they don't tell the story well enough. And so my philosophy is make sure there's a story to be told, as well as the fantastic gameplay and content. Because it's very easy to say, you know, what's going on. But, you know, I want to try and provoke the audience at home to have a connection with one of the players, you know, for whatever reason. You know, I want them to feel that they want this guy to win, this guy to lose, and then when I commentate, I'll hopefully be able to tell them when that guy's in trouble or that guy's got his winning moment coming up, so they're on the edge of their seat. So commentary, that was my first time with Corey Dunn, and yeah, I transitioned over to that and continued just because I felt it would grow esports a lot more than me playing.
So Quake is it's not dead, but it's still beating for the past year and a half, kind of in the competitive spirit. But do you miss casting it when we had the WSVGs almost I think every other month or something like that, when it was in its heyday? Do you miss that that period in your life?
There was one WSVG that carried on, and I was there playing World of Warcraft, and I actually got to cast Quake. Every time I was out of the World of Warcraft tournament, Slasher and Joe Miller would get me on.
Yeah.
And, you know, so, because Slasher was, like, quite a big fan of my commentary back then. So he was, like, every time I could cast Quake, he was, like, get Jay on.
Yep.
And I wasn't actually getting paid for any of the commentary I did, and we talked about getting, like, $100. I, you know, this was WSVG. Like, it was a big project, right? And I was doing their Quake commentary for free. Fnatic were flying me out there for free to play in the World of Warcraft tournament, where we weren't doing very well because I changed my teammates from Vu and Strider because I didn't want to train or play the game.
Right.
And picking teammates from the internet rather than actually knowing them beforehand, it didn't work out that well. But I really liked the guys. They were still really cool guys, but we just didn't bond on LAN in terms of how we played. So I remember, I got to cast Quake then, so I didn't miss it. And basically, I was still professional in terms of my level, so I gave really good commentary, much better than I would give now. And I remember asking, you know, like, can I have $100 an event? And it was like a big thing, you know, like, we're going to pay this guy? you know, and they're using all this, you know, super fancy equipment, and, you know, they're booking out comic cons and stuff. So yeah, it was like even then in 2006
or 7, I still can't remember.
No, it's 2006. No, 2007. Even then in 2007, commentators weren't really getting paid.
Yeah.
It was like, we can get you there, you do your shit, we'll pay for the hotel room, that's fine. And for me to ask for $100 an event, I think Joe Miller was earning about $300 an event.
It was low. It didn't spike up till StarCraft, man. That money was always low until kind of the MLG days, and then with everything else coming into the StarCraft scene, it started to go up.
Yeah, and a big respect to all the guys back in the day that, you know, pulled through, like Red Eye, Tosspot, you know, DJ Wheat, that actually put their heart and soul despite there being no real money.
Yeah, we didn't get paid for like 6 years, guys. That's the honest truth.
Yeah, but right now, I mean, commentary's fine in terms of what people get paid. Some people maybe get overpaid, but it's not a problem if the companies are happy to pay that wage. I mean, actually, when I met Apollo at and I asked him how much he was getting an event, he used to earn $300 an event.
Yeah.
Apollo. And when you can that's some of the other StarCraft and I'll assign you gigs and get you up to a full-time salary rather than earning, you know, Apollo, because I got him his first DreamHack gig, because DreamHack actually allow me to kind of recommend things that they're not sure about, you know, so I say, get this kid Apollo, he's going to be great, and they got him and put him with Day 9, and he was great, and then, you know, I got Apollo up to a good normal salary now. He's not overpaid, and he's not earning $300 an event, so lucky for him.
Well,
but yeah, he was earning 2007 salaries.
after the WSVG died, kind of shockingly to everyone involved with that, you went on to work for ESL. You moved to Germany, I believe, with Joe. He didn't live there prior to that.
I actually worked for Fnatic as a team and general manager.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
And because I originally started off pro gaming in Dignitas, did the whole pro gaming thing. Transferred over to Fnatic with a buyout of the contract, which was probably the first one in eSports, actually someone to buy someone out their contract, because I made them do it because I wanted it to be proper. Went to Fnatic, managed to become team manager pretty quickly because I enjoyed looking after someone like Cypher and all that other stuff. Got promoted to a general manager status once I finished playing. As a general manager, working under Stan Matthews was interesting. It was great for so many opportunities, but it was very hard because he said, please run the company. And then he also said, but really, you can never run this company because it's my baby. So even though he was working on New Game, it was quite hard to run someone else's company when you didn't really get to run the company. So I wasn't a great worker. I had a very much gamer, you know, in me in terms of, like, you know, I wasn't very strict on myself. And so I got in Joe Miller to help, who was actually, you know, probably better than me. But I was very good at meetings and getting initial contracts signed, you know, bringing in sponsors, you know, I was really good at setting up all the networking stuff. And Joe was really good at helping get all the PDFs and stuff done. And basically, at one point, I just had enough of Fnatic. I ended up getting in a fight with Sam Matthews. Like, it wasn't really a fist fight. Yeah, it was a fist fight. There was a bottle involved at the beginning of it.
What is with you in bottles, man? You got hit but in the head with one like a month or two ago. Oh, Skype. I think he just got hit in the head with another bottle. As there is an internet connection problem with Skype. I hate you so much. I'll have to get him back in the call here in a second. He probably blue screened or something like that. Well, this is unedited, so I can't edit this out. It's too bad. I think he was going to go on to tell the story of why he got hit with a bottle at DreamHack Invitational that happened a couple months back outside of a bar. I don't know who hit him. I was hoping to find that out. But yeah. Let's see. Yeah, he is actually full on offline. So we're going to go to a short little break. And when we come back, we'll have more real talk with Too Good. Sorry about this, guys. Skype, fuck you.
Remember, sorry about my internet. When I talk a certain amount of bullshit, as I said, it has a built-in bullshit threshold and then turns itself off. But yeah, Sam Matthews tried to bottle me as well from Fnatic. Luckily, it kind of just bounced off the pool table and then he ended up just taking a fight with me. But I don't blame him for that because, to be honest, I wound him up pretty fucking good. But me and Sam Matthews are actually quite similar. That's maybe why we didn't get on so well in certain areas. But it was really fun working for Fnatic, and the opportunity was great. And I think Sam had a lot of things right in esports in terms of image and promotion and stuff. So, yeah. So we're from Fnatic. I got asked to host ESL's Player Awards, which I did. Which was basically I said stand up, introduce people, guests, and be like a host, you know, like the eSport Oscars. Yeah. So I stole loads of jokes from the internet and made some up myself. I was really drunk when I was on stage. I got progressively more drunk as the show went on.
Nice.
Yeah. And to the one point where, like, Mark Olberts from Blizzard was backstage. Oh, and I was a little bit too drunk, so I introduced the wrong person to come up, and so the person was like, what? And so he came up on stage anyway, and everyone was in my ear like, James, what the fuck are you doing? But it was really good, and basically ESL offered me a position to commentate World of Warcraft, and I, you know, thought it would be able to be the best position for me to promote esports. And I think, you know, we did a lot for World of Warcraft, certainly at ESL, and we did a lot for Quake as well. So that was really good. Yeah, I enjoyed that a lot. Worked with some really good people at ESL, and continued commentating for there for a bit until I left, you know, a little bit later.
A couple questions about ESL. First off, what was it like? You moved, correct, completely out of where you were living prior to that to Germany, to their studios?
Yeah.
What was that transition like?
It was really good. Yeah, it was, yeah. I mean, when you live on the internet, it doesn't matter where you live, right? As long as you have the internet.
Right.
So basically, I lived in Southampton working for Fnatic with Joe Miller. Moved to ESL, lived in Germany, and I was meant to be head of the English department, so I put together a couple of group of commentators. It was Matt Ryder and Joe Miller. And when I moved to Germany, I just had a blast, man. Like, it was so much fun. Like, England, lots of fights and, you know, not so pretty girls. And Germany, the only fight I ever fucking saw in Germany, the whole 2 years I lived there, was between two English guys called Joe Miller and Matt Ryder. But no other problems apart from that. It was just those two, like, for 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. I think Joe was drunk on the floor and Matt had him in a headlock for about 30 minutes. And I was sat on a bench and women would walk past and I'd invite them over to watch the show. And I'd give them a backstory on why they're fighting.
Nice.
And I met a girl who looked like Cameron Diaz that night. She was really hot. And then eventually Joe got on top and sat on Matt for the next 30 minutes. It was quite even.
Yeah. How's Matt doing? What has he moved on after
Matt
being brought to killing himself casting with
He actually moved on to be a community manager for, I think it's called Bullfrog, which is in Berlin. He has a really nice girlfriend in Berlin who works with special needs kids, which I think is quite fitting if you're going to date Matt. And basically, yeah, he's over there. And he actually done some shows. He's done some Bullfrog update shows.
Huh.
Where he's sat there and hosted with another guy who speaks really thick German, and they talk about what's going on with the game and all that other stuff. So he's actually taken a little bit of what he learned to there. But I think he's doing good. Yeah, I mean, I haven't seen him.
Yeah, I haven't seen him at all.
Yeah, I mean, he added me on Twitter, and then he's got in a conversation with me on Twitter, and I called him useless, and then he ended up fighting about why he wasn't useless, and it reminded me when I used to work with him, because I was like, Matt, I asked you to do one fucking thing for the show. Not only did you not do it, you didn't do it in time, you're late, you know, you fucking this, and this, and he ended up fighting with me like we were working again, like, you know, who's doing what? And so I ended up just blocking him on Twitter.
Nice.
And he ended up messaging Joe or something, asking him to unblock me, so I unblocked him. But I was like, Matt, we're not going to bring this back up. I love that guy to bits, but I fucking hate working with him. Yeah. Jesus Christ.
Poor Matt.
He was brilliant, though. He was brilliant on camera, but yeah.
So at the end of your ESL career, you've told the story before a couple of times, but a lot of it is kind of unanswered. Were you essentially fired from ESL, or did you leave on your own? Is that about that, or?
Yeah, it's fine. I did an AMA, and I had someone from ESL message me saying, not cool, bro, not cool. But basically, the story is, they wanted to send me to a cosplay fucking convention to talk about Trackmania, which I do not play, and Counter-Strike Source, which I do not want to cover, and I wasn't really doing any professional games there. I was going to bring up people from the audience at a cosplay convention to play Trackmania, and I was going to do promo on the Alienware laptops. Now, so basically, to give a little background on Alienware, I might shoot myself in the foot, but I just don't like Alienware. I think it's overpriced, and I was working at the Intel Extreme Masters, which was sponsored by Alienware, and I was the commentator for the Quake tournament in Dubai, and this woman from Alienware comes up to me, and she says, hi, I'm from Alienware, would you mind, you know, doing a little, you know, a little talk, just, you know, some promo for Alienware? And I said, nah, sorry, I can't do that, you know, I can't remember if I said I don't believe in the brand or she had to talk to my agent or something. But I basically just kind of gave her the impression is like, you know, I don't particularly like Alienware as a product, even though they're a bigger sponsor here. But you're not going to get, you know, me saying I love Alienware, because at the end of the day, I have people that actually follow me and actually care about what maybe I say. Maybe there's not many, but I don't want to say something that I don't believe in. So I told her this, and she was like, oh, God, how do you sleep at night? And I was like, on a big pile of money, and walked away, and she didn't like me. So when I got asked to go to this event and promote Alienware and take esports to the wrong type of audience, take games that weren't the games I signed up to commentate with, I sat there at my desk, contemplating and just thinking, fuck, I don't want to do this. This is not what I signed up for. And I decided about 2 o'clock in the morning that I wasn't going to be able to say no and have a job. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because I was meant to leave at like 6 o'clock in the morning and I wasn't going to say yes. So I sent an email to Toby and I said, hey, Toby, I'm not going to go to this event. I know what this means. So, you know, you can consider my job cancelled, you know, because this is not what I signed up for. My last month's wage, if you have to find somebody to replace me, you can deduct my last month's wage for the replacement fee cost. But I won't be going to this event, and unfortunately, I won't be able to work for ESL anymore. Maybe in the future, I suggested that if they wanted me to come back and do a couple of gigs here and there, that would be fine. But I was very set on leaving and doing something different because I actually found Bloodline Champions, and I didn't have the job with Bloodline Champions at the time, but I kind of felt like I could do something for them. But I felt like I wasn't doing as much Quake, I wasn't, you know, World of Warcraft. I wanted to start a Hon show at ESL, and they kind of like didn't think I'd be able to handle it. So I was like, okay, I'm not in control of what I can do on camera. And I was like, so I actually tried building my own studio at the house. But when I said I was leaving my job, my housemate actually cancelled the new internet connection, so I couldn't stream myself at the house, even though I spent like part of my last wage on a new PC. So I sent, yeah, and I actually rang him as well, Toby, and I said, look, I'm sorry. And he says, oh, you're not going, we're getting someone else. And I'm like, yeah. So I contacted Red Eye on behalf of ESL and said, can you replace me? I know it's really short notice. He was in another country. He said he could do it. So they brought in Red Eye, who always does a great job. And him and Joe did, you know, that event at the cosplay convention, which I think was a farce in my all seriousness. I think, you know, I remember watching the stream and just thinking, thank fuck I'm not there. And basically Red Eye saved my ass. And, you know, in terms of not having too much bad between me and ESL. And since then, yeah, it's been okay. You know, I've worked with ESL in different parts. You know, I've helped them with commentators like Apollo. I've bought ads on their websites with Funcom in terms of Bloodline Champions. And yeah, so, you know, we're all good at ESL. And I never disliked the guys.
Yeah,
I just didn't like what I was doing at the end. I just felt like this isn't what I signed up for. So I was really happy to... I mean, my philosophy in life is like, I will shovel shit if I can do what I want to do. You know what I mean?
If you can shovel it your own way.
Yeah, well, but I won't shovel shit one day just to shovel shit the next day.
Ah.
You know? So it was more like, if I do this, I'm going to be doing it again and again. And I just felt like it wasn't for me. So after that, I took my last 300 euros that I had in my bank account. I contacted Stunlock Studios. I flew out with my last 300 euros in the world because I spent it on a new computer and all that other shit. And I went there and did a talk with Bloodline Champion Stunlock Studios and said, you know, this is what I could maybe do for your game. I could get you involved with these different leagues and all that stuff. And I remember having a really great meeting. Just all the employees were there and they... And, you know, a couple of them had big smiles on their faces because they knew me from World of Warcraft. And I joined the company for the cheapest price I could offer them because I knew they were an indie company. So I joined for, a salary lower than my ESL salary because I didn't want to, like, burden them. And I didn't know how successful we were going to be. And then Funcom was signing at the same time, but I didn't know about it. And then when Funcom came on and signed, I did 6 months. And then I went to kind of a Funcom position where... I was more in the marketing side of things, but yeah, so the move from ESL to work from a commentator to work in a game studio was good because I felt like I had direct control of how the game could be for an eSport.
Yeah.
And it started off really strong, but I think the game generally lacked, you know, some depth, and also it just didn't, it wasn't maybe the right time. It wasn't, you know, as good as the, as a Dota, you know, but it wasn't replacing World of Warcraft, and, you know, it did a lot for its community. I think the community were generally very happy, and they're still quite happy. Star Ladder are doing tournaments for it, and everybody knows the name Bloodline Champions, and I like to think I, you know, within eSports, I helped that become apparent, and the guys are doing great at Stunlock, so I felt like it was a good move where I could help a team get into eSports, and I think that was a bigger deal than me commentating.
Going back to ESL for 1 second, there's recently been another kind of shuffle in the casters over there with Mr. Bitter and Rotterdam leaving. Do you have any insight as to why this happened? If there was any negative aspects of it, was it a clean leave for both of them? Do you have any idea?
I think that ESL has some of the best employees and best people. That's for sure. Because when I watch them work, like I seriously think they're levels above other production companies, ESL. But I also think that ESL TV is sometimes kind of constrained by the league ESL, because they're different. Different. ESL TV, if it was a standalone company, it would be more like Teg TV, where Teg TV can do whatever content he want, or The Good Studio, where we can do whatever content we want. But ESL TV is constricted to what ESL has to offer. And ESL is a very big company. Originally, when I was working there, it was about 140 people. And I think that sometimes the commentators maybe want to do things differently or more. And sometimes they can't because of the way the league's structured. And I also know that NASL, yes, they have investment. I actually spoke to their investment company. One of the guys that runs it actually was like one of the, he was like the third employee at MTV, you know, ever when he was younger. And I think with ESL, they keep quite a realistic view on esports, which is why they've been around for such a long time, in terms of, like, you know, they pay proper salaries, but they don't go over the top. They, you know, pay prize money out, but they don't necessarily go over the top with it, or, you know, they might take a little bit longer. And I think the attraction of an investment company behind NESL and maybe the commentators having a little bit more say in the product, because it's only one product that they have to worry about at NESL, that it was more of an appealing for Mr. Bitter and Rotterdam, because originally Rotterdam was going to stay at ESL and Mr. Bitter was going to leave.
Oh, really?
And yeah, and Mr. Bitter was like, you know, if you don't get Rotterdam, it's not a big announcement. You know, it's not the same. You know, so they ended up, I think, you know, because Rotterdam was actually like, I'm going to stay. It's, you know, yeah. And then they ended up putting him away. So I think they had to entice him a little bit more with the green. But yeah. So I don't think there's any bad blood. I think maybe, I think Ben's personality type, the fact that he has all these great ideas and wants to do all these good different things, probably didn't fit ESL that well, because ESL has like a plan and a structure, and Ben was probably similar to me, where he's like, I want to do this, and they say, yeah, that's all great, but, you know, can't make it happen for you. So I think maybe Ben fits an ESL a little bit better, but I don't think there would be any bad blood between them, because ESL aren't those type of employees and employer.
Gotcha. Yeah. You mentioned, of course, going to Stunlock Studios and working kind of as a dev for the first time in your life. Is that something you could see yourself doing long term? Yeah.
Actually, I think Sunlock Studios is the only esport developer there is out there. But their second title, you know, can't talk about it, but, you know, it looks good, but maybe not so esporty.
Okay.
But basically, after leaving Sunlock Studios, I was looking for projects to be involved in. And, you know, because it was like Funcom weren't really putting in more money into esports. And I was sat there and I was like, basically said to the guys, I was like, look, guys, I've pulled so much shit out of my ass in terms of, like, I've raised tournaments, I've pulled in prize money, and, you know, Funcom, they've done a bit at the beginning, but they just don't seem to care as much as they used to. And it's not because of the results, it was more because, I don't know, like, you know, I think they expected Bloodline Champions to be a lot bigger than it was. So I think it became a lesser priority for Funcom, which is quite sad. So I was like, look, guys, every month I'm sat here, I'm taking your money. I was like, you know, I can't do that forever. So I said, look, within 2 months, I'll probably find, you know, a new job. You know, I'll go out and see what there is to do, fun, that I want to do. And I said, you know, I'll still support your tournament. So when I went and got a new job, I actually got them a $15,000 tournament with Twitch TV at DreamHack and partners. The game happened or Twitch was actually to make another game, and I wanted to raise money for an FPS esport game. Is my webcam freaking out?
Well, it was like
your head.
I'm just I hate you, Skype.
Oh, it's Skype being funny.
Yeah.
But yeah, I tried raising money to make the next eSport FPS game, and I only needed $2.5 million to do it competently. Like, that would have been an overestimate of the money needed. And I went to see a investor, and they were really interested in what I had to say, and they actually invited me in because they already invested in eSports.
Okay.
And we spoke about the game, and they said, yeah, that's nice, but we're actually looking to do something a little bit bigger. We want to spend $100 million. And we want to make an MMO. And I was like, facepalm. I was like, why would you want to go into the MMO market? I was like, there's one good game for one, there comes a great game for one genre, and everyone tries to copy it until it gets so saturated. And I was like, an FPS eSport game, like true FPS eSport game, would be the return of something brilliant. You know?
Yeah.
So sorry if my webcam's fucking up. I can see my webcam going crazy.
Yeah, I think it's more Skype, not really your webcam. It's trying to... It keeps bouncing back between HD and standard def, but regardless, your audio is fine, so let's just go ahead and keep going on. Can you talk about the FPS at all and perhaps why they didn't like it?
No, they just didn't want to do a small project.
They just didn't want to do it, okay.
And, you know, the only ideas I have to get this FPS game off is to either reduce the budget to $250,000, make a development team, who I know who they are. They're different people from different places. The Blowfish, who used to be a Quake 3 guy. Baxter, who was the lead artist for Sunlock Studios.
Gotcha.
And then I would try and convince Sunlock Studios to split their team up a bit and pay like a year and a half salary to make the game, you know, and to give them some substance and just slow down their production of their new game. And do a Kickstarter, and the game was going to be called Reborn. It was basically to cut a lot of costs. I would, rather than like in Battlefield where you would have 200 different models and 200 different facial expressions,
right,
I would make it very simple and have one female, one male skin, make them the same size, try and keep them not like human but maybe robot-y, where you could put like Fnatic logo or SK logo on them and customize them. Concentrate on animations to make a move. Concentrate 6 months in doing the physics engine with Blowfish and some of the Stunlock guys to make sure it moved. I would use Faz and Fox as the two guys that would actually make sure this happened. And then after 6 months, if the physics was fine and Baxter had made the art style how we wanted it, I would go into map design, where we would make three different skins of maps in terms of like just three different environments of maps. But each of them would look, they would just look and feel different, but they would play similar in terms of shapes and objects. Basically, from those three maps, I'd only make three maps for the whole game. So I'd make two characters, one set of animations, three maps, and then I would make a map editor for the community, where basically we would have a shopping game, and what would happen is if a member of the community made a map, the game would I would make the game like maybe free or like, you know, some way of free to play, and then I would maybe do a collector's edition just so the hardcore fans could support us, you know, and the people who donated on Kickstarter would support us. And I would make three different maps, and I would give all the static meshes, is what they're called, all the, you know, stuff that we've made in-house with Baxter, etc. And basically, the community would be able to make a map. They'd upload it to the shop, okay? So if it was a premier map and got past our support team, which would have been professional gamers, so it would be like hopefully the Quake community, like Noctis and all the stuff, would play these new maps, and they'd be like, this is really good, this one deserves to be a sold map. So what we do is we put that map up for sale as like you know, some sort of, if you want to play this map, it's going to cost you $1 to add it to your map pack. And then basically, if you buy that for $1, it would have to sell it would have to sell like 5,000. It depends on how big the audience was, but let's say we had 1 million players. Let's say we say that map has to be sold 5,000 times. Once it's sold 5,000 times, the guy who made the map from the community gets $2,500. The studio gets $2,500, you know, because the map editor has allowed you to do that. So we both split the $2,500. He's made a month to make the map. He gets like a full-time wage from that 1 month on making the great map for the community. 5,000 people buy it, which means that after the 5,000 people buy it, it becomes free to everybody. So the people that want to support the game and the content are able to buy the map early and, you know, play it and enjoy it and support the map maker and the studio. And then all the casual players that are never going to spend the money anyway, once the map is sold, they get to play it for free. So we release the game with free maps and a good editor, and we say to the community, make your own maps and you can make money off it. That, alongside having things like clans and being able to upload your own sponsor skins onto your, you know, equipment and stuff. Uh-huh. You know, we can also charge like, you know, $1 to Fnatic to have their Fnatic skin uploaded. And then basically the game is run by the community, and we just make sure that the physics was good, the weapons were good, the particle effects were good, you know, the spectator UI, the eSports side, and all that other stuff, which can be done in about a year and a half. Right. So I think the whole game, with a small team, maybe under, you know, under 10 people, could probably make that a stretch at $250,000 if some people worked as volunteers. But if I was going to do it properly, I would have a proper team and do it for like 2.5 mil. And the only way I can make this happen is either because I need to be involved in it because of all the design elements that I've came up with Fox and Faz and stuff, and also just making sure it has all the is I either need to get Notch and say, hey, Notch, do you want to support the Swedish company and a new game like Quake? Because I know he loves Quake, and I know, you know, he's a Swedish company, and Mojang were actually a similar startup to how Sunlock Studios was in terms of university. Or I do Kickstarter, and I have to kind of quit the good studio, as well as, like, you know, move some people to Stockholm, which is going to be hard if I want to do both, because Sunlock Studios are down in Hovde. Yeah, or basically I win the lottery and start it myself. So it's Kickstarter, Notch, or investment. But I'm not looking for investment because when I spoke to the guy from the investor from who originally was one of the original guys of MTV, when I went to the investment meeting, they had a document on me and what I did. And they read it and they were like, we don't know what you do because you do everything. And so basically the guy who was head of this investment company took me into a room and for a private one-on-one, you know, to figure out what I'm like and stuff. And he gave me some advice, and he just basically said, you know, you do a lot, and it's a lot of fun. And I used to do that when I was young. But the best thing is to do is just try and concentrate on one thing. So I put the FPS game on a back burner, and I'm concentrating on the Good Studio, which is my version of esports to, you know, our industry. Because I believe much more in eSport entertainment than I do in just eSports. So, you know, I'd like to be, with the project, considered to be an entertainment side of eSports, but still holds the integrity of eSports rather than just pumping out games and ladder matches.
Right, right.
So, the FPS game, yes, let's make it happen. Go on, everybody. Go message Notch on his phone. No, don't.
Notch. I think that the average viewer watching that and listening to you describe the game is immediately going to say, shoot mania. And I know that you actually on the Good Studio the other day were saying that it doesn't...
The thing is...
Yeah, I mean, go ahead, I'll let you say it. I won't speak for you.
I don't care if they made Chat Mania, but Shoot Mania, from what I've seen, looks like a big pile of dog shit.
Have you watched the matches, the show matches, past there?
Yeah.
Too?
Okay. I watched them for like 10 seconds, and I haven't played it, so this might be me talking out of my ass. But let's just say, if you're going to make a good eSport game now, every developer, every coder, everybody is out of date apart from the eSport community. Id Software aren't even up to date on what will make the next best eSport game. We're going to see new versions of the old stuff. Quake is not the best right now because it's out of date in terms of game mechanics. It's very beautiful in terms of how well it plays, in terms of its game mechanics and movement and physics, but it's out of date for the new generation of eSporters, which demand a little bit more from their games. StarCraft II is friggin' fantastic, and you know, Dota is, you know, done the test of time in terms of the mechanics and how intricate that game is. But basically, if you're going to make a good eSport game, I would literally work with the physics system more than anything, and I would make the game so much fun just to run around on without anybody playing on it. Because in Quake, like Clan Arena or CPMA, you can just run around a map and enjoy the movement system. for being so banned. Movement system is worse than Unreal Tournament, from what I can tell. And so they have an idea of like, yeah, we're going to make an eSport game, but they have no eSport fucking knowledge on the FPS side, and I doubt any pros have been involved. Yeah. And if I was to work on this FPS eSport game, yes, I'd want the experienced developers with the physics systems, and maybe we use UDK, maybe we make our own system, you know. But, you know, at the same time, you need constant checks from professional gamers. You know, even though Fox and Faz would be my main two guys to kind of back up on in terms of, you know, our, you know, core group within the studio, I would have make sure that everybody outside in the Quake, you know, industry that we think would, you know, have an opinion, you know, would be able to test the game from as early as possible. You know, but we would make sure that the vision and what we had in mind would come. Because I haven't told you all the game design ideas in terms of weapons and
right,
different mechanics,
right.
Because I don't really want to say it. But
yeah, please don't. Just go make the game.
but it's more like, I don't think there's any real eSport company out there as in a game developer company for eSports.
Right. I know that there are people on the team for Shootmania that have eSports interaction and have they're players, basically, but they're not tip-top pro-level players that I kind of like what you want to get with Fox and the other guys on the team, so.
I mean, yeah, like, Fox, you have no idea how fucking intelligent this guy
is.
Oh,
yeah, I know. I know from Slasher telling me.
He's like, we're playing Diablo 3, and he programs his own, like, macros and scripts and shit, and he's made a macro that logs him into Diablo 3 automatically, Act 4, takes him into the game, runs him over to the vendor, checks for a ring that has vitality and plus 40 resistance to wall. If the ring's there, buy it, and then, you know, fill up his bags, and if not, restart the game and keep going. So basically, his account right now is just running, because he's done all, he's like a coder and shit, but like, the way he looks at games, he's like meticulous around numbers. Like, he cannot get someone who's more... He knows everything about everything technical, like he'll read everything. And then Faz is just like a fantastically creative person. So I wanted two guys at the other end of the spectrum to kind of sit either side of me and then use the community with those two fighting over what should happen. And I think we'd have a good mix. So I'm really disappointed that I couldn't get it up and running because I did have some really nice meetings, but
well,
okay.
Hopefully we didn't just get Fox banned in Diablo 3.
Yeah, we probably have.
It's all good. It's all good. He could just get a new account, make another character. Now, let's talk about the good studio, your current project. First off, where did this idea come from, and what made it go from an idea to kind of a real thing, a real living, breathing studio?
Basically, when I was at ESL and I left, I tried starting my own second stream. Okay, and it never worked because I told you I didn't get the internet connection because Sean unfortunately cancelled it when he knew I was leaving the job because I was probably leaving country, which I did, so not his fault. But one of the reasons that I felt it was quite good to leave ESL was I wasn't getting better as a commentator. I was just kind of doing the same, so I felt like I needed a new challenge. But I also felt like if I stopped commentating for a couple of years, I'd love to come back and do it with a lot more passion, the passion I had at the beginning. But if I was to do that, I would need the whole project to be my project, you know, like 100%, you know, like the content that I want, the imagery and just how I want to do esports. So I want it to be under my vision. And then once my vision's there, I'd very happily share it with others and anybody who I feel could come in and work on this project, I would very happily give them a percent of the project over a period of time and allow them to make their segments of the project their own as well. So basically, I felt through helping a lot of people get jobs in esports and helping a lot of people get, you know, commentary gigs and making sure everyone gets the right prices. It's really funny because, like, I speak to DreamHack and I say, hire in control. DreamHack go, that's a great idea. They're like, how much are we paying? I say, this much. And then they go, okay, that sounds good. Then InControl goes, and I go to InControl and I go, they're going to contact you. They're going to offer you this much. Make sure you take it. That's a good amount, okay? He's like, is it? I'm like, yes. It's very good for your first event. Take that money, InControl. And then someone else from DreamHack, who wasn't in the original conversation, gets to contact InControl shows InControl and offers him less. But that guy doesn't know I'm in conversation with In Control, getting all the information. So In Control pastes me what the guy says, and I go, no, ask for this much and say these are the reasons. And In Control like types out what I say. And so I'm actually doing negotiations with both of them like a puppet master. But at the end of the day, DreamHack get what they want, and In Control gets what he wants, and everyone, I get the right price. You know, I don't, if anyone works with me, they know I don't negotiate. If you ask for something, I'll give you one price. You say no, or, you know, then the deal's off. And if I come to you and offer you something, I give you one price. I don't do any negotiations because it's a waste of time, and I'm very, I know how much most, I know, I'm probably one of the most, I probably know how much people are turning over and how much people are making more than anyone else, at least in Europe. So yeah, the earning ship money, let's help him out. I really want you to come StarCraft 2. I can help you and I can get you up to a full-time salary, which I did. Semler, I met, got him. Trance, who I basically worked with, I got him involved. And basically, when I joined Twitch TV, I kind of wanted to do a side project along my Twitch TV job, which was meant to be like European manager, but I'm much more of a networker for them. You know, I put together the team, but they pretty much run their own, and, you know, I just network and make sure everything's happening. It's basically, I wanted to start a project on the side that helped Twitch TV, helped eSports, gave opportunities to commentators, and also do eSports in the way I wanted to do it. So the whole project has only cost me about, I mean, cost me to build and do that whole studio about 20,000 euros.
Yeah.
You know? And I think in the first year of all the work that I put together to the guys, we're probably turning over about 300,000 a year.
Nice. So it is profitable then. Very profitable.
Yeah. That's a turnover. So there's salaries and there's prize money and there's, you know.
Are there any silent backers to it? Is it 100% self-funded?
It's 100% funded by me.
Okay.
So I put in all the money, but the guys are putting all the work. So basically, without Trance doing a lot of his organization, you know, Apollo doing all his StarCraft 2 stuff, you know, like. It's more about time than it was money, because I promised the guys that I would get everybody up to a 30,000 euro a year salary, you know, if you join the team. And I've done that for everybody apart from one person right now. But he's on about 20,000. So by the end of the year, hopefully we can get him up to 30. It's more about selling the sponsorships at the right price. And in the first 6 months, I didn't oversell any of the deals with, you know, I don't like overselling projects. I like selling them for cheap, seeing how it goes. And then hopefully we do a great job for our sponsors. We can up it in a neutral way that both of us benefit. Which is already looking to happen. We're already looking to do more with certain sponsors, and we might even be doing some LAN events, etc.
Awesome.
But basically, yeah, I pay myself zero from the studio. Trance pays himself zero from the studio. We pay all our prize money, you know, that we offer out. We're about a month and a half behind, but we're clearing it in about 2 weeks' time. We're waiting on invoices from sponsors. And then, you know, it's good. So, you know, the whole Twitch TV, this is like our group of guys that work here. It's not like just a studio that does 300,000.
Gotcha.
But it's everybody that comes together as like, because I don't actually work. I work for Twitch TV, but I actually own three different companies, which are split up into different departments. So there's one company, which is for me, my consultancy, etc. There's another company which is eSport events and production, which is a couple guys under, and there's another company which is for shoutcasters and an agency, which you know, does, you know, the invoices. And I even help out some other guys in the industry who can't have a company to invoice DreamHack, and right. If they don't invoice through a company, they lose 40% tax.
Wow.
So they use my do, and I always. I actually earn the least in the whole house.
Well,
but I have the company cards.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go. Was there anyone that you asked that said no to the proposition of coming and working in the studio?
No, everyone was really up for it. I mean, I met everybody and I helped everybody first on good terms. Trance didn't have a job in eSports before I helped him, and I got him into DreamHack, and then I got him into Twitch TV tech support. So I gave him a job in eSports. Semler didn't have a job in eSports, and I flew him off my own money to come to DreamHack to commentate Bloodline Champions, because I felt they didn't have the budget to fly a commentator like him. And I said, you have to do it. So I took the money that Sunlock Studios were paying me, and I was like, well, it's not really my fucking money because I'm not doing any work this month. Let me just fly in people off this money. So I flew in Hafu and also Semler and also an English guy to make sure there was 10 teams. So, it was about, 3,000 euros, but I don't class it as my money. I met Apollo a long time ago, and I introduced him to DreamHack for his first gig, and DreamHack basically was the company that gave Apollo his stage of being awesome. And, you know, we've taken him from, $300, an event, to a much better, still under some people's 10,000, which is overpriced in an event, to around what people should be making for an event appearance, which is around about 2,000 to 2,500, which is fine for, 3 days of work plus, 2 days of travel.
Can't wait to see that Reddit thread. Who gets paid $10,000 an event? Number one on Reddit. I'm sure it's coming up.
Ask me about people's salaries, because I actually know. So I won't answer.
Yeah, but the sad thing is I'm kind of the same way, but for the US scene. So.
Yeah, but, McCormick, he's our video guy. I helped him, get to DreamHack and do all these cool things that he wanted so he's got a job in this now. And we're bringing in... a couple more. We're bringing in Scriff and Weppas to help on the studio, and because we're doing okay, and and basically I'm replacing myself as CEO from all the companies. So I'm actually going to be closing the companies after 1 year of trade, which will be later this year, and I will be starting one company that houses all the projects rather than just because it's a hassle for me right now, and I'll be replacing myself as CEO with someone else that I'll be hiring in, and I'll be able to focus more on eSports and work, because right now I spend a lot of my time doing accounts and invoices and making sure everything's running. But basically, the whole good studio runs like this right now. We're not driving in any fancy cars, but we're not going anywhere. We're not going under. And after our first 6 months, we will be able to hopefully work with our sponsors in a better way, work with the community in a better way. And also we're looking to work with large event lands. So there might be a time where we, the good studio, could produce a live event, awesome. which will be good for us. So, and I look to get more people involved as well. So any commentators and, I wanted Joe Miller, but I couldn't get him. He didn't say no.
Yeah.
I just said, I'll give you this much money. And he considered it. And then I couldn't raise that money, actually. That was one of the first times. But I don't have any room for anybody more at the house now.
That's kind of the next question I have. Here you are with a bunch of your close friends, good friends. Is there ever a moment where you guys should be live or you should be working and you're all just drinking? Like, is that a problem, staying on task in the house?
No, actually...
You just go live and drink? Like, is that the answer?
I think the good studio and what it embodies and the fact that we live together is a lot of fun, because it's kind you kind of get that a better bond with the guys you work with when you live with them.
Yeah,
no absolutely. One pisses anyone else off in the house. It's really good. Semler, actually, despite my reputation, drinks the most.
Really?
We had to ban Semler from drinking before shows, because we were like, for fuck's sake, Semler. I was like, it doesn't matter how many bottles of whiskey I buy from my own little private selection, Semler will find them.
he puts cameras on the cats, man. They're doing the scouting for him.
Yeah. But no, we have a good time. We watch movies together. We play games together. Everyone gets their work done. I actually believe that commentators should play the game. So I only tell Semler and Apollo their job is to play the games they commentate. Yeah. And then to help organize, you know, the players if they know more than us, which they do. And Apollo, I think, is one of the best StarCraft 2, like, player commentators out there. Like, if there was a commentators all playing in a tournament, I think Apollo and Rotterdam would definitely be up there.
Yeah.
You know, I think Rotterdam's fantastic as well.
I think CSN's actually trying to put together a tournament like that.
Yeah, but I don't think the commentators would do it because they're all...
Yeah, well, that's the other thing, too, like... There's no way a Day9 or a Tasteless, Artosis maybe, but like the big guys, there's, like you said, there's no way they put it on.
You shouldn't be scared to be bad. Like I'm quite a bad Quake player now, but I'm not scared to play a bit on stream
because
I still understand what's going on in game. I understand the intricacies, but I'm, you know, I'd rather play rather than be feared of what the community backlash may be.
Yeah, I'm the same way.
Yeah, I think the most important thing for commentators is to play the game. And well, Apollo plays the game a shit ton.
Right. Like, and to hit on that more, that with Apollo streaming, to be able to stream yourself playing the game for credibility reasons makes it so, so worth your while. Because, I mean, that's what I did when I was kind of focusing on the casting. As of late, I haven't, to be honest, played a game in about 2 months. So played StarCraft 2 in about 2 months. And that's why I'm no longer casting at the next MLG, because I took myself out of that role. But streaming like that and playing the game and showing the audience that you're actually good and you know what you're talking about is very pivotal. There's very few people that actually do that.
I think people fear. They have a higher fear than they do. You know, you just really... You need to... Yeah. I mean, I can understand, like, you know, I don't particularly like Day9 as a commentator, and I've said this, you know, like, I made a comment where I said he's done a lot for the community and a lot for himself. And people kind of, like, took that into context, and someone had a go at me. But basically, it just means is he's worked hard, he gets paid well. If anyone disagrees with me, then, you know, you shouldn't. But I personally don't like his commentary style as an analyst. I don't think he's as good as an analyst as other people, because when I sit with Apollo and Apollo watches other commentators cast tournaments and then he's telling me what's going on, which is different to what they're telling me, and then what Apollo says actually happens, I'm like, oh, you're actually really good. Yeah. And I just think that I think Day9 is starting to play more again. And I maybe think one of the problems that Day9 has in terms of, like, dropping off in terms of how good he is as commentator is because he's trying to run his own business.
Yeah.
And I can kind of empathize with that, because I've got worse in different areas of my life from trying to do a brand thing where I'm part of the brand, which is the Good Studio. And I know that Day9 TV and also the Red Bull LAN is also under his flagship, if you know what I mean. You know, it's a direct correlation. So I think, you know, maybe... I don't know how the infrastructure of his company is, but maybe he needs to give up some control and actually focus on, if he wants to still commentate as well as he used to. Did I upset anybody there? Was that? I
think no. That's a fair comment. Well, that's actually the segue into the next kind of topics is we've covered all the topics that include yourself.
I want to spend me. That's talking about me.
I want to spend some more time talking about some other things, because you're kind of in the unique position where you've actually pissed off everyone already, so you can say whatever you really want in the long run. Come on, you've pissed out a lot of people, so. Let's just start off with pretty generic. What are your thoughts on the current game within eSports? You're somewhat kind of a Quake purist. Is StarCraft II, the MOBA world, fighting games, are these legitimate eSports in your eyes?
The Quake, what do you mean? Is StarCraft II, fighting games, are they eSports?
Yeah, are these like the games that should kind of lead eSports forward at this current generation?
I think StarCraft 2 is actually one of the best, if not the best, eSport game out there. I think when Quake has its magical moments, they're sometimes more magical than anything else. But StarCraft isn't over until it's over. And sometimes when I watch Quake and I see, like, you know, it's over in 3 minutes, but I'm watching it to watch some guy just stomp, it doesn't feel very eSporty or entertaining. So I think StarCraft 2 has some really fantastic entertainment. So I think all the eSports that we have right now, my favorites are StarCraft 2, Quake, Dota 2. outside of that, I still think, like, you know, fighting game community stuff and or everything else has a, you know, a place in esports. I, you know, there's no real, I mean, esports is it's to be an esport, you don't have to be a LAN. You can be a Team Fortress 2 online tournament. You know, you can be so many different things, but it's the concept. I mean, some, you know, the concept is there for all of them. They all deserve to be esports. The entertainment value and the stars and the companies working around the titles for a reason and the developers supporting, the ones that are esports definitely deserve to be there. Even League of Legends, even though I, you know, personally, I think League of Legends is, you know, dog shit, but as a game to play for me, it's just not fun enough. But for newer people into the competitive scene, you know, I'm sure they find League of Legends quite a challenging game to start with, as well as, you know, obviously tying shoelaces and crossing the road. But, you know, it's a stepping stone, right? And it's, I think it's quite good.
Kind of in the same realm of question, what developer is actually doing it right and which are fucking up right now?
I think Riot and Blizzard are doing the best job right now. Basically, Riot... I still look at some of the developers using esports more as a marketing tool than an actual esport competitive platform, in the sense that if you go to Gamescom and you spend, Gamescom, the biggest, you know, expo for video games in Germany, not sure of Europe, but you go to Gamescom and you buy X amount of floor space for your game. So you've got there, you've got League of Legends, you've got Dota 2, and let's say you've got these titles and you pay, you know, 100,000 plus for your booth space. With this money that you spent at the booth, and in reality, the whole cost will be way more than 100,000, I promise you. You end up spending over $1 million, you know, depending on how big and crazy you want to go. And basically, you've got this, and then you think, okay, Gamescom has 330,000 people in foot floor or something around that mark. They count per day, so these could be the same people coming back in from day one to day two. And mm-hmm. so you realistically think, okay, we're only hitting maybe 250,000 people with our booth, and that's even if they come to our booth. And then you say, well, why not stick a $100,000 tournament or even a $1.6 million tournament on top of our booth? And then we have the potential with this esport tournament to reach, you know, 3-5 million unique viewers over for the whole, you know, again, the tournament. So I think some developers have caught on to big tournaments bringing big publicity. I think Riot showed that first with how they publicized their game and their tournaments. And it's not a discredit to Riot. It's more like they kind of proved to other people that if you stick up $1 million prize money, people are going to fucking pay attention. And so we saw Valve do it with Dota 2, you know, etc. So I think the Riot are probably doing it the best because they're supporting the organizations a lot more. There's a reason that more organizations have signed with League of Legends and others, and it's not only because of, you know, how good or bad the game is, it's a financial thing. And the fact is, if their player base and their game is an esport game and they're using this company, they should pay. Previously, people like id Software, you know, Valve back in the day would never pay ESL to run tournaments. It just wouldn't happen, you know. They would actually ask for a license, you know, so that they could run the tournament. So Riot have taken it on themselves to pretty much support the industry. So they're doing it the best, I think. Valve, I'm not sure how they're going to do it and change it. I know they're doing this, you know, tournament every year with the international for 1.6 million, but I don't working in a smaller capacity to support people. I think it will end up being Own3D and Twitch TV that give most of the prize money towards you know, tournaments around Dota 2, which actually it already is, because a lot of tournaments have been on Twitch and owned that have been supported by you know, the money from streaming.
Right.
And then Blizzard are actually doing the next best thing. So rather than Blizzard paying, say, ESL and saying, hey, ESL, we're paying you to do the Internet Stream Masters, okay? Rather than them doing something like that, Blizzard are actually doing something different. But I think it could actually be better than Riot. Because what Blizzard are doing is they've created their own brand, which is the World Championship, is it? I can't remember the exact naming. The
Blizzard World Championship.
Now, Blizzard are doing something great here, because what they've tried to do is they're trying to take their eSport department, which for a long period of time, the Blizzard eSport department hasn't really meant anything to fucking anybody. Like, 2 months of Stunlock Studios just not doing anything. But the Blizzard eSport department seems like they're actually fucking on top of shit, at least in Europe. Yeah. And basically what they're doing, Blizzard, is they're taking the World Championship and they're taking it to a regional level. They're going to Italy, Germany, and all these other places. And they're bringing the brand of Blizzard to these places, which attracts a lot of attention. Blizzard will have more people turning up to an event than the Intel Extreme Masters, MLG, or DreamHack. Across, you know, the world globally, because it's a Blizzard event. They expect, you know, some signings, promo, you know, sneak peeks, you know, maybe, you know, play stuff. But also at the same time, there's a tournament, and it's a regional tournament, and they're having a lot more competitors at these LANs than maybe Intel Extreme Masters or DreamHack would if they went around the world. But what Blizzard is doing right is that they're, by doing this project, they're actually expanding StarCraft II to a bigger audience, you know, because they're using the name Blizzard to bring in more people. And while they're doing that, they're not running all their events single-handedly. So Blizzard are actually contracting people like DreamHack, people like ESL, to run these events. And that means that they're actually giving ESL and DreamHack money in the same capacity that Riot would give them money. And, you know, you're paying for them to do your job. But in all fairness, if Blizzard weren't paying that money for everyone running their StarCraft II events, it wouldn't be hugely profitable at the end of the year, or even maybe profitable at all, for companies to run StarCraft II off PPV, off subscriptions, off ad revenue, off sponsorship alone. Because it is a tough business to run tournaments. So Blizzard are doing a great thing because they're finally kind of backing up financially, and not just with, they've always given opportunity, but now they're doing now they're giving finances to the people that have taken the opportunity and run the best events. So is it like MLG are probably going to run something for Blizzard, right?
Yes, we have the Nationals actually going on at Anaheim.
And Blizzard will pay for that, and MLG have got that opportunity because Blizzard obviously agree that maybe MLG run the best type of tournaments that they want to represent the Blizzard brand. So as opposed to when you started StarCraft II within MLG, you would literally just get a license that said, you may do StarCraft II. And then the whole finances is off the back of MLG, if I'm not mistaken. Which I don't think I am, but I could be, unless there's some weird deal over in America. But now, yeah. but now they're actually like, you've done well. We're running this World Championship, you know, and we're going to pay you to run this event. And the fact is, you know, this won't only just cover your costs. It should make you a little bit of money on top. So, you know, it supports eSports financially. So yeah. Blizzard and Riot, and I think Blizzard may be a little bit smarter than Riot, if you know what I mean. Like, I feel like they kind of get eSports a little bit more, you know.
They've been around longer, I think.
I think those two companies are doing the best for those two reasons. And then outside of that, you know, Valve, I don't see them changing policy. I really hope they do. I really hope they, you know, do a little bit more. You know, and id Software right now, you know, they have a support team that gets lands and stuff, but, you know, it's, they have to go through levels of hierarchy to get, you know, people at ZeniMax to say, yes, we want to put money into Quake Live because, as opposed to, why not just make new games? So, Blizzard and Riot right now.
All right.
Doing it well.
Next question I got for you, you hit on this a little bit, but we got to revisit it. So, when you said what you did about Day 9, you actually started this anti-Day 9 movement that kind of... You actually did. There were rumblings of the movement kind of beforehand where a lot of people were starting to believe him to be pretty narcissistic and things of that nature. But ever since what you said on the show, whether you've brought out the trolls in the community, the 1%, or what, but every time there's anything Day 9 related... there's more negative posts about him than I've ever seen before. Because for a while, it was like, if you talk shit about Day 9, you're going to get your account banned. You're not going to be able to do to do anything on that thread or forum. Well, what do you think about that?
The thing is, is that I like saying stuff like that. Not to get myself in trouble. Not to say something like, I don't like this guy. Or I can say I don't like someone's commentary because that's just my own opinion. No one has to like my commentary. And I'm actually, as a commentator, you can't have too much of me because the way I commentate is quite, not over the top, but it's quite crazy. So you don't want me on a day-to-day basis. So I take that into account that I'm not that kind of commentator. And I agree that, you know, people won't like me. And I'm happy that everybody, you know, doesn't like me as a commentator. So the thing about Day 9 is what I don't want to see is I don't want to see another fatality.
Wow.
That's a little bit why maybe I'll happily make that comment. Because it's fatality, for people who don't know, fatality was a Quake professional, and he was really fucking good. Like, he was. And he was one of the first people that took training and this tournament seriously. And, you know, he got to the top of his field, and he went on great. But then, over the time, fatality has, in my opinion, despite I like the guy, he's sold his brand, so he's not in control of Fatality. He doesn't run the Fatality brand. Suits run Fatality brand. He doesn't support, in my opinion, the community that helped build him, which is the Quake community. He's putting money into League of Legends, and that's a business decision, rather than, you know, actually I want to some credibility or do something nice for people who've supported me. And I know, you know, yes, John has made a lot of money through his endorsements and his shit. You know, when I see Gamer Food, fuck me, I would never promote this fucking Gamer Food. And then there's Fatality with fucking Gamer Food. And, you know, he's got a house that he's bought on Venice Beach, which is worth, you know, a couple mil or whatever. You know, I say to myself, yes, you've made a lot of money. You've done very well. But you're now in a position where, you know, you should be doing something more than I personally think you are.
Mm-hmm.
So when I look at John, I think to myself, well done. You know, I don't care how much money you make. I don't care, you know, what is this. But, you know, you've lost a lot of credibility because you're not doing things for the community as such. You're doing things for your brand and yourself. And you know, maybe that's not my business to say that, in the sense that, like, if he wants to do things for his brand and himself, that's fine, you know. Me, I prefer putting my money back into the community and tournaments and, you know, and whatever. But it's like with Day 9, it's kind of like, maybe when I say that, like, in the back of my mind, it's kind of a provocative warning, in the sense that I've seen people in your position before where you've been the head of your industry in terms of figure and opportunity, because no one gets to work with Red Bull, like only Day 9, and Red Bull is a fucking huge sponsor, you know what I mean? Like, Red Bull is like, if you can get them to work with personally, the money that they have available for this kind of shit is massive, okay? So you're in a big opportunity. So I kind of wanted him to think maybe about where he is and what he wants to do and how he wants to continue to give back to the community, even though he's obviously done a lot. And that's why I don't like judge Day 9 in terms of like, okay, have you done too much or too little? He's done a huge amount, and I'm not questioning that. It's more of we're in people in power. I just don't want to see it go down another path where you know, it becomes less beneficial for esports in general and more for one person. As I said, I don't care how much money people make. If I really wanted to, I could make a lot of money. Right now, I pay myself about £700 a month, because that's the minimum salary I can give myself without paying tax. But I still have the company card. But like, I would rather like invest all my time and money back into the industry. Now, if I was to say, I know how much a similar aspect of what Day 9 earns, yes, I have an idea. I could be wrong. I could be right. I don't know his infrastructure. I don't know how many people he's paying, how many volunteers, who he's working for him, what his in and outcomes are going. But I also feel that he could, I wouldn't say do more, but I just think like, I think his commentary is lacked. And I think maybe, okay, he's maybe working too hard on other elements of it. But I just, you know, I'm just, I'm not, to sum it up, it's like, where Fatality went, I'm not a Fatality fan. Okay? I liked Day 9 at the beginning, but where he's going right now, I'm becoming less of a fan. But he's in the game and he can do anything he wants still, and you know, the bringing Red Bull in is great. So like, I want to see where he finishes up. So I'm not like saying rah 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 pitchforks. I'm saying, you know, I want to see where he goes, and I don't mind if I really hope if I said something and then people said something and it made him think about where and what he's doing. You know, that would be good.
Yeah.
You know, and so, you know, and like, you know, like with Sundance as well, it's like, okay, I'm a fan. You know, putting, you know, Kessler players exclusivity and then having to talk to other people in terms of, oh, do you want Kessler type players? But I'm also not a fan of Kessler because they share, in my opinion, like they worry about the business side of things in the sense that, like,
right,
we must have a stronghold on our business and a strong business point. When I think in the esports, the strongest business sense you can have is by doing things the community want and doing things the right way. Because my company, 20,000, and I set up all these contracts, and it's not just a studio, you know, it's all the other jobs that we have in between, like event management that turns over this much of money between us. So, you know, we're not making a huge amount, but we're very stable, and we're going to hopefully do better and better and bring in more content and stuff. But I've not ever done like something exclusive or ever done something, you know, like I've not kind of tried to stronghold the competition or try and run tournaments over other people's tournaments. I just try to do good tournaments that people want to see for the community, and people have subscribed and people have watched, and sponsors have looked at me, and sponsors have said to me, like, people resonate with you better than other partners because you seem to be so much more honest with what you do in esports. So we would like to sponsor you instead of these people. And they're amazed when it's a cheaper price. And I just wish, you know, I just hope, you know, Day 9 continues to do better things. Rather than has done good things. You know, it's be a better gamer, right? So
I think that's a good way to sum that up. He's still going to get shit, though. There's nothing we can do about that.
I don't care. I mean, I don't care. Because I can actually, in this industry, I think I put in a lot. And if I want to give someone a warning, as in, like, up your game or, you know, think about where you're going and what you want to be considered and where you want to finish, they can either be offended by my opinion, or they can take my opinion, but I don't give a fuck if they're offended by my opinion, because it's my opinion.
Yeah.
So, I want everybody to be the best they can in this industry, because I've worked a lot to get it where it is, as well as everyone else, you know, and when I see sponsors getting fucked over by teams, I fucking hate those teams, you know, I just want people to handle their business well and do the right things. And if they earn a lot of money, that's great. But make sure that you think about where you want this to go, because this isn't a short-term plan. It's not make a few mil, get out. There's a lot more to this industry than people know right now. And it will take a while before we get there. But we aren't going to get there if it's just a small handful of us. It needs to be everybody on all cylinders, working on all fronts.
You mentioned casters in there, and Sean kind of upping his game. Just straight up casters who should never cast another StarCraft II game, in your opinion. who needs to improve?
I'll break down some of the commentators and what I like and dislike about them, just because it's my opinion. I'm allowed. Basically, JP McDaniel should probably not bother casting anymore.
Yeah.
You're much better at these type of content. You have a bigger network than most people in esports, so you're able to get hold of and have the reputation to do good work in this. And I think you don't need to cast StarCraft 2, you know. And then when you casted with Day 9, Sean, at BlizzCon, how many times did you say his name?
The video was... Hold on.
Yeah.
Video was 127, I think. But apparently Husky beat me in that count at the Red Bull final.
All right, so I remember thinking that before that video was out.
To talk about that for 1 second, That was actually the most nervous I'd ever been. You've seen crowds like that before, James. That shit. That was the biggest crowd that anyone's ever casted in front of.
Hey, just get.
I was freaking out. I should have had some whiskey. I should have had some, but
I went up in front of I went up in the Blizzard event in front of something similar size.
Yeah,
and it was on TV France.
Oh.
Whiskey's my... No, I didn't actually have whiskey there. I just had Mark Olberts kick me up the ass and tell me to get on stage. And I almost forgot. Yeah. But it's a learning experience.
Oh, definitely.
But, like, the thing is, like, I'm sure you'll cast again, but you don't need to, like, focus on it. I think it's something that you can do when, you know, you want to do it. Rob Simpson from Blizzard. I actually think he's okay at casting. I really like his voice, but I wish he wouldn't move around like a ferret. when he's listening to other people, he does all these crazy faces. Me, I don't think I should cast StarCraft 2 because I don't play the game, even though I'm casting tomorrow. So I definitely shouldn't be doing that.
See,
but I'm only doing it to help
you. Exactly.
Apollo.
You just hit on a good point. There's people that cast out of necessity for their jobs. And I think that's a lot of people don't understand that.
Did you have to cast? Were you forced?
I was not forced to cast. BlizzCon had nothing to do with MLG. I did that because it's fucking casting BlizzCon. Like, who's going to say no to that, even if you know you're not the best out there? But
I said no to casting BlizzCon.
No, you didn't. You said no to hosting it or casting it?
No, I said no to casting World of Warcraft at BlizzCon.
Oh, okay. Well, you should have done it regardless. Who ended up casting that? Was that Isaac's first cast?
Something like that, but I said no, why are you...
I don't know. It's casting BlizzCon. That's always been, like, a dream since I started doing all this, so I lived my dream. I'm happy with that. I'm content with that.
I should let you some of my dreams. They're a lot more fun.
But, yeah, just casting on necessity. Like, doing the MLG things that I do cast, it's because that's what I was initially hired for. That role is changing for the better now, but... People like yourself as well, like you're casting tomorrow because you have to. There's no one else that could...
Yeah, but I'm not drinking tonight. I'm going out tonight to a party. I'm not going to get drunk, I'm going to be as good as I can for Apollo.
All right, continue on.
But basically, I could tell you, like, some of the commentators I think are doing really well. But I think Rob Simpson can be good. He obviously knows the game. DJ Wheat's fucking fantastic. Like, you can't beat someone like DJ Wheat in his hosting commentary style, because you could only really get Red Eye or Tosspot to kind of match him. He's just too professional that when he's put with a great analyst, he really compliments. And then you've got people like Husky, which actually are really interesting to me, because Husky is quite new, and he reminds me a lot of Tosspot in the sense that he actually has a really great, not style of commentary, but, like, he includes everything that you should into to commentating. But he obviously needs an analyst as well. But, I mean, in the end of the day, it's like, I don't really give a fuck who commentates and who don't. Because if I don't like him, I might not watch him. And if I like him, I'll watch him. So I don't think anybody should stop doing it if they like doing it, apart from you, JP. You are by far the worst. But I honestly think if they enjoy commentating, they should continue commentating. And if they don't enjoy it, they shouldn't do it. And it's fine if people don't like them. And it's, you know, it's no difference if people like them. Because, I mean, Total Biscuit went through a lot of crap with people not liking him at the beginning.
Same
but
as
now
Husky.
He's, you know, but he liked it. He enjoyed what he did, and he carried on doing it. So I think people should just fucking do what they enjoy doing in life. And if the people on the internet don't enjoy a commentator or an event or a personality or an interview like this one, then, you know, then fucking watch it. Just do something you enjoy doing. Life's too short to get pissed off with stupid shit.
There you go. So, in terms of teams, were you done in terms of all the casters?
Yeah, I mean, it's not really my place to say who should and shouldn't work. I think everyone, you know, is entitled to, and if they have an opportunity, great. I mean, I haven't found anybody in the industry that I just felt like, oh my god. Because I'm actually not that good at StarCraft 2, so even if I get someone who's really shit commentating, I don't understand it that well. I can get rubbed the wrong way by commentators when, like, I can kind of be like, that just didn't feel natural or feel good, or that wasn't really funny, or you're trying too hard, or, you know. But it takes a while for people to be able to define themselves. Like, the first time I was on camera, I'm sure I was quite different. That I am today. You know, hopefully I'm more annoying now. I would hate to think otherwise.
And teams, like, who is doing the best right now as a team, kind of all-encompassing? Management, players, player management?
My two favorite teams right now in eSports are EG and Team Dignitas.
Okay.
Basically, EG, financially, looking very strong. You know, yeah, Monster absolutely. Is there. So, and I also think that the fact that they've not only thought about picking up pro gamers that are going to win tournaments, they've also thought about picking up pro gamers that are going to, be the face of their team in terms of, like, in control. So I think that what they're doing with their sponsors, with their promotion, with their team, with their website, with, you know, their tournaments and all that other stuff, I think EG right now is the number one in the industry that people should look at. I think Team Dignitas are doing an amazing job in terms of back-end, in terms, you know, financially they're strong. They work with sponsors brilliantly. If they want more for the team, they ask more from the sponsor. They don't promise players something they can never deliver. Team Dignitas are just so stable, and they've grown from strength to strength. And you must remember, I knew Team Dignitas when they were only considered a UK semi-pro team, you know. Yeah. And they were ranked the same as Infused Gaming, Reason Gaming, and all these other teams in England. And it's taken them a while to come up, you know, and surpass 4Kings and even Fnatic, in my opinion. So I think that those two teams are all encompassing because they do many other games, and I think they both run their businesses great, and I think they both support their sponsors great. There's a lot that we don't see with in terms of OD, selling 20 videos to this company done by Zuckerberg, and we obviously like the Kingston stuff done by the team, in terms of those videos. It's all the management that set it up. So the fact that they are doing that is great. Outside of that, it's quite hard to judge right now. I like what Team Liquid do, but I think Team Liquid is more impressive as a community than it is a team. Right. But I think that they're doing okay. They've only really got, one Razer, I think it is their main sponsor.
Yeah, and then Little App Factory in some capacity, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure if they're still giving money, but I think they did a lot, Little App Factory, to Team Liquid. Yep. So I think Team Liquid will never remove that logo anyway, because they're too, they're just too cool of a guy. But they do a lot of great stuff in terms of image, Team Liquid. They're very good on the image side. And I think Victor, despite being new to esports in terms of, like, the business side of things, has already done very well. Like, spoke to him about some numbers that sponsors should be giving for title and head and different positions, and he's really, on the ball. And I think they're very happy with Razer, which is great. But other than that, everyone's just kind of plodding along. But I personally don't necessarily believe so much in teams in esports.
Really?
Okay. Well, it's
I get what you're going at, but yeah. It's interesting.
I like, they used to exist more back in the day because a team brand was stronger than the personality. Because we were very limited to the amount of exposure we would have. If you remember 4Kings back in the day of Quake,
absolutely,
you might remember the names like Blokey, Mist, Deuce and stuff, but you never really saw these guys because there wasn't many LANs. And so 4Kings was more of a, like, amazing performing online team before, we had the Warcraft 3 come in. And these guys, or anyone who played for me, I'd probably named the wrong guys, and Blokey was playing for UNR, but you know what I mean, like Gun and other people and Vorth. But the point was, is like, we didn't have exposure to these players. So we just kind of looked at them and said, they're great at games, winning. 4Kings is great. Right now, we're in a stage where the players have so much exposure that I believe that the player can be stronger than the team by himself. Great example.
You cut out.
This is grubby.
Okay.
Oh, really?
No, you're fine.
All right. So you got the audio of me talking shit?
Yes.
So basically, I think that, like, teams right now, they're not necessarily needed. I think they're going to stay, and I think they're still going to be established brands. But what I think there is a place for in East, which I think an agency compared to a team is a lot bigger, because a team works with a select few amount of sponsors, right? Let's say, let's look at EG. Let's say we got six sponsors there. When a team has six sponsors, Okay. And these six sponsors basically are all time investing for the size of the team. Because in the team, you have a lot more than just, you know, the managers. You've got news writers. You've got, you know, maybe you've got an accountant here. You know, whatever. But the thing is like, EG probably aren't as connected with sponsors worldwide as a team, as an agency would be. Okay? Because they probably don't have the time or the resources to actually go out and you know, connect with all these people. But an agency... Like, even, like, some of the best agencies in Sweden, like UMG. UMG, you know, they work with Coca-Cola, Nike, Adidas. You know, they can work with any brand they want because they're one of the biggest, you know, agencies. Let's say a player goes to an agency and be like, hi, I'm this person. Over a year, I will have this many tournament appearances. I will be on this many, you know, TV stations. I will be in this many papers. I'll be on this many streams. I will connect to this many people in this geographic, in this demographic. That list of information, if that player can organize it and take it to the agency has a whole book of sponsors that they can call up and be like, and you only need one sponsor to be able to fund one player around the world. It doesn't cost that much because, you know, you just need like a personal website. It's a lot much less maintenance. And then at the end of the day, you can customize, you can give more customization to the sponsors. Because if I want to sponsor Team Dignitas as a sponsor, I'm like, okay, so I have to get the whole of Team Dignitas. I'm only really interested in the Romanian market. And you've got a Romanian Dota 2 team, or did, but they don't have any more.
Right.
And I have to pay Premier figure because I can't have just the team. I also need to be on the website or you know, that deal isn't there. And I'm spending money from my region, and I only have a certain amount of budget to expose esports in Romania. But when I spend this money, I'm also being exposed in America and all that stuff. That's great, but I don't. That's not my budget. That's someone else's budget. Now I have to go talk to another department. And it's like, you know, whatever. But if an agency just had a player, the sponsors would have an easier time connecting to where they want to be within esports. And I think that an agency could easily support so many players, you know, easily like 50 to 100 in the StarCraft II industry. I think teams are great for a different reason, even though, like, that's why I think they won't go away, is because off the key players of the team, the sponsorship money can come in, and also how good the brand is of the team. And then other players underneath that title player get an opportunity because, you know, maybe EG are looking to, you know, nurture new players. But I would love an agency for players, because I've already got an agency for commentators, you know, and I've got commentators in Europe up to like a certain standard that I think is acceptable, and they think it's acceptable. But I think an agency for players as well would be very beneficial. Definitely think so.
Kind of, you mentioned it there, but you mentioned it also a lot throughout this interview. The topic of casters making more than players, players being very outspoken about this, I guess, well, just to name the elephant in the room, Cloud, of course, making the vlog that he did regarding a lot of the salaries the casters make and whatnot. Does this need to stop? Is this a good thing that's happening where...
The thing is that the one problem I found in Cloud's opinion was he was comparing apples and oranges, okay? Basically, if you're a player and you're put into the player pool of salaries and et cetera and what you do and how you have to train, that is your choice. Okay? So if you're a player, Cloud, you know, be a player, earn this much, and if you want to earn more, you can. If a commentator gets paid a higher salary, so what? If a commentator doesn't have to work as hard as you, so what? There are some players that obviously earn more than commentators, and there's some commentators that obviously earn a lot less than players. But the point is, it's like, it's not even worth comparing the difference between salaries and a commentator and a player. I didn't see the reason for a comparison. I mean, sure, you know, like, you know, I you know, I could compare, I don't even know, but I just don't think it matters. I think that players, there's a lot of them. I think commentators, there's a lot less. So maybe it's just, you know, supply and demand right now. You know, in terms of commentary, you know, if you want the best commentators, then they maybe have to pay more. You know, if they charge a ridiculous amount, you know, that's not always good. I don't agree sometimes with a ridiculous amount, but if people pay for it, then okay. You know, but yeah. Don't know really what to say about that, but
yeah,
I don't think it's a compare. I don't think he should have bothered even trying to compare.
Okay, all right. Couple more questions. I know this is actually running longer than I anticipated, so I'm sure you're one to get the fuck out of here as soon as possible.
I don't really care. I'm a bit of a narcissistic megalomaniac who enjoy talking about myself.
Spend a couple minutes on kind of each tournament out there, looking for somewhat of a report card, just across the board, how they're doing, what they're doing right, what they're doing wrong, starting off with IPL.
IPL right now, I think, started with higher hopes than they anticipated the effect of IGN would be on eSports. I still think eSports appeals to people within eSports. It doesn't really necessarily mean that IGN are magically going to quadruple our numbers. I think it's, you know, we already have an established industry through, you know, the networks that we have around eSports, the Reddits, the threads, and, you know, all the news sites and team sites and stuff. So I think that IGN started off very strong, and I think that they've been cutting back. I think that... that maybe IPL are currently struggling a little bit. I think their image was good to start with. I think that their latest LAN performances weren't as strong. But generally, it's kind of like... The big thing about eSports and events is you're only as good as your last performance. You know, it's kind of like sports or something for a sportsman. You're only as good as your last performance because, you know, that's really, you know, where you are now. And that's, you know, we're such a... moving industry that people won't remember past. You know, they only know what was your last performance. And I think IPL have weren't as strong on their last performance as they were at the beginning. And so right now, I think they're probably pondering over about where to go and what to do with their brand, which I'm interested about. Obviously, you know, partnerships with like GOM TV and bringing over the GSL, you know, like that's a bold move because they paid for the flights for that, you know. Yep. And that's a lot of money, you know, and even though, I keep saying, you know, now, why the hell am I doing that? Even though, you know, they got sponsored, not going to say it anymore, some areas in Vegas. I wonder how long I've been saying, you know, throughout this talk. You know, used to be my commentary think word and I got rid of it.
Yeah.
So maybe it's back. But I think right now they're not as strong as they were at the beginning. So I'm interested to see where they go and what of NASL upping their game and MLG will be. I hope that they stick around. They have some of the best production. I think their philosophy on commentary was very poor. I think David Ting should have focused a little bit more on the commentators and who's commentating the finals and why you bring these commentators in than in-house. You know, Cat's Pajamas, yeah, he's fine, you know, but at the same time, I think it was HD, weren't as strong as maybe you could have at a big event like this.
Okay.
So I think that their team, their production is great. I think that their image, and I think David Ting leaving that company lacks image to make it a better brand rather than what he does best, which is more the engineering side. So I'd be interested to see where IPL go, because I think they might lose their cool very quickly after the next Vegas event if they don't do something very good.
All right. Next up, NASL.
NASL, they have a timer against their product because they have investment. And anybody that has investment has to start showing return. Look at MLG and PPV. There's a reason that started, and the reason is investment. So once you take investment, you have an opportunity to do great and wonderful things. But you also have to make sure that they pay off. I think that NASL have upped their brand to the highest stage that it's currently been with Season 3, with the addition of Rotterdam, Mr. Bitter, and also the little segments they do. But I fear as well for NASL and America that three big organizations fighting over the community's attention might be two or one too many. So I kind of think that NASL, if they don't start, you know, earning a certain amount, and I'm not sure how much it is, and I'm not, you know, I know they have a lot of subscriptions, and you know, they have, you know, they're doing good, but you have to see what their investor wants against them. So maybe they're doing fantastic, but I personally think that they're looking to do better. And I also think that whenever you take an investment, you're up against a timer to show some sign of return. And I think NASL have now upped their product, and they're looking for a return to show their investors. And I hope they meet their, you know, kind of quotas, because I don't think that NASL Season 1 and 2 were good at all. And I personally think whoever had to answer to the investment team was literally an apology. you know, because, but I like their brand where it is now. I like their product. So it's more about the business model behind it. And they're flying a lot of people in for these fight nights, right?
They are, yeah. Every single time, every week, I think there's two new players. I think there's one tomorrow night, so.
And it costs money. But I don't think NASL have the full picture. Like, they don't have a complete brand. Do you know what I mean? They don't they don't have they don't seem to be the best at anything, but they're good at everything.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's not enough just to be good at everything.
Well, they're also on air every night too, which is no other league does that, which I think is kind of a unique thing.
Yeah, I think that's quite important. I think that's how they got so big and how they got investment in the first place, because their page views were like 45 million very quickly, so I'm sure that was a very impressive stat. And regularity is a big way to build your brand.
Absolutely.
Certainly for YouTubers, it was all about regularity. But yeah, I'd be interested to see where NASL go.
And rounding out kind of the North American market, MLG for the last one.
I think MLG have the best product in America, but I think that they think old. In my opinion, I believe that.
Please don't let me preface this. Please don't say anything that you, or please feel free to say whatever you want. Just because I'm on the show,
I will.
This is not an MLG sponsored show at all.
I try to say it in a way where I don't have to answer for myself to different emails afterwards.
Okay.
Just because I can't be bothered answering to people, but I can say what I want to say, but I don't have to swear while saying it. You know, I still get my point across, but I'll just do it in a way I want. MLG have probably the best brand out there. The reason that is because, yes, Blizzard have picked them to run events for them, which is great. They also have signed League of Legends as one of their games, which is also another financial benefit. Even though they have taken $56 million investment, I believe is the correct number, over the period of time, correct?
I have no idea, to be honest. And I'm not just, like, fluffing that.
You can actually go check it out on the websites about the company. But this is over a long period of time, and they survived, you know, the heartaches of eSports, and they're here. They currently, yes, have the best brand. I don't think signing players on exclusivity is a good idea. I think it hurt their image. I personally think that the players under Kesper shouldn't allow Kesper to run where they go, what they do, and why, because the players going to MLG probably didn't even know they were playing in a mini tournament. They probably thought they were just doing signings. I think that the way of thinking where you have to think about exclusivity and strong-arming your competition out is a fearful way of running your business. And I think that with MLG being the strongest, they should, rather than be fearful, you know, kind of be a little bit better they want when they want. But hopefully MLG is the best event in America that everyone's going to want to be there, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
So I think they're a little bit old mentality in esports, but maybe with myself saying that there's maybe one too many big LAN tournaments in America, that maybe they're doing the correct decision. But image-wise, I don't think they're very good on image. I mean, I find it quite amusing that when MLG release statements about MLG and Kesper, they mention DreamHack a lot, and they mention EIEM a lot. And now what's funny about this is there's a press release talking about Kesper and MLG, and they mention DreamHack. And it feels like they're so bad at PR, but they mention DreamHack, and people mention DreamHack like, oh, we're talking to DreamHack, as if that's something to talk about. It's not... I could talk to DreamHack. I'd just fucking get someone's phone number and be like, I'm talking to DreamHack. Put this in my press release. But it feels like DreamHack are the coolest brand out there right now. The MLG, knowing, I think, that they're not as cool as they would like to be in terms of image, that they mention DreamHack more than some of the things that are actually happening. And I just think that they need to... I don't know. I really hope MLG would definitely stay around. Where they just need to, you know, as I mentioned the other day, stop being, a little bit pussies sometimes.
Another thing sure which blew up on
but, you know, it's just like, they have such a great brand, and your graphics for MLG have got way better. Your production's got way better. The PPV tournaments, yeah, sure. I think actually the PPV tournaments are going to go downhill over a long period of time, because I feel that MLG have offered too much too quickly. For example, when you bring in all these StarCraft II pros at once to your tournament,
right,
to up it next time, you have them play in the main tournament. But then to up it next time, it's hard. And I think when you look at what eSports is, I think people always look and ask for more in entertainment.
Right.
So I think that MLG will find it more difficult. Hey, Sam. Will find it more difficult to kind of attract these people to want to pay, you know, for the PPV experience. So I'm sure the first one actually got more viewers than the next one. And you nodded your head, so I'm taking that as confirmation. But, you know, so it's a challenge, and I think that if MLG want to better themselves, they need to concentrate on some image and PR and how they run the tournaments and what's fun for people to watch at home, and just think about the community a lot. They're really good at thinking about players, because they fly everyone out there, and teams are like super fucking happy. They're like, really?
Yeah.
But then what's the responsibility of the team? So
yeah. Well, maybe it's to make sure their players don't show up drunk.
Yeah. But it'll be interesting to see what happens. But MLG aren't going anywhere, and they do the best LAN live events as well. So they're winning on a lot of fronts, MLG. So I don't think they should be so scared about the competition.
Or, just as what you said, don't be a pussy.
Yeah, don't be pussies.
Moving over to Europe, ESL, kind of the quiet guys, so to speak. At least that's how I view them. What are your thoughts?
ESL, I think Carmack made the mistake of undervaluing commentators, similar to how IPL did. I think that the StarCraft 2 within Intel Extreme Masters, and it's primarily talking StarCraft 2 because I know your community is, even though MLG have done a lot more than just StarCraft 2, etc., and certainly Intel Extreme Masters and ESL. I think that Carmack made the mistake of undervaluing commentators because he wasn't willing to put out for bigger, better names. And Extreme Masters, until they started realizing that maybe it's worth bringing in Grubby and Apollo and having something a little bit more special. But generally, Intel Extreme Masters is quite an interesting project because it's not run like the other tournaments like MLG. There is Turtle Entertainment, which runs all the leagues, and also Intel Extreme Masters, and then there's Turtle, which runs the leagues and Intel Extreme Masters, then there's Turtle Entertainment, which runs the TV side of ESL. So, they're two different products, and both of them have, you know, various different employees, ESL TV being a lot smaller, CEO'd by Sven Hoffman and also Tobias Greiser, and, you know, Intel Extreme Masters is actually budgeted through the Intel marketing department. No, Intel events department, I think. I have to get this correct, because otherwise I'll say it wrong. But basically what it means is, it's like, it's coming from a department that I don't think it should be, in the way that it's an event department. So basically, the Intel events, I believe, is funding the Intel Extreme Masters, and the Intel Extreme Masters is at the event, But while the Intel Extreme Masters is there, the money that comes in to run the event gets handed between Turtle and also Turtle Entertainment, which is the TV side, which are really good. And then they actually perform marketing tasks, if you know what I mean. So the company, I think it's called GM, can't remember. George is the head of it, or head of the project. But I think it's called like GM something, but it's an event. So they're in charge of Intel events. So the budget is actually a lot tighter, I can only imagine, for ESL within the Intel Extreme Masters than it maybe should be. Because I think Intel Extreme Masters should be taking more budget from Intel rather than, you know, just to be taking budget from the event side, actually to be taking budget from the marketing side. So this is the last, you know, I heard, and I could be wrong, things may have changed. But I just think, like, I just don't think there's a lot of money in that project, the Intel Extreme Masters. So I think the fact that they're still around, the fact that they're doing things on a continental, a cross-continental level in terms of, you know, traveling around, they're not really comparable to anybody anymore, because Intel Extreme Masters is a project that just basically, takes Intel out there. It's not like an MLG, which is an all-encompassing. It's not a DreamHack, which is an all-encompassing, you know, kind of eSport company. The eSport company is Turtle and Turtle Entertainment, but the Intel Extreme Masters is a marketing machine for Intel run by the event budget through a third-party event company. So it's quite odd, and I'm very surprised that Carmack's been able to do still quite a good job with it.
Absolutely.
I do feel like the image, I don't think Mac is great on image, and I don't think that he's focused on always the right areas in terms of, you know, what he can do. But I think if I ask Carmack to be able to do any more in terms of player promotion and all this other stuff, I think it will be a budget problem. But Intel Extreme Masters will never go anywhere. And I think the addition of League of Legends and StarCraft 2 will potentially, hopefully, help them be able to bring in bigger budgets from Intel.
Oh, were you done? Sorry, I don't want to cut you off. Yeah. Okay, well, the other league, of course, DreamHack. And before we get, are you involved with DreamHack? Are you on staff? Are you a consultant? Or
I've never charged DreamHack for anything I've ever done.
Okay.
I do everything for free for them. I did one thing for them, and I was meant to get paid, and they tried paying me, and I told them to put the money into a Quake tournament, and it's going to be a free-for-all tournament, and it's going to be Tony free-for-all tournament. But I do everything for free when I can, because I am quite stable. So DreamHack I don't work for. I introduce to people that I know in terms of, you know, some networking sites, some players. I brought investors to the company, and I've tried, you know, they listen to me. So if I come up with an idea for like StarCraft 2 tours or etc., I try and do that. And also, you know, obviously with Twitch TV, I've worked with them in a professional way where we're doing the players lounges at the events, which hopefully bring a better experience for the players at all of the events around Europe with Twitch. So DreamHack are a different bull than anyone else as well, because they have the LAN side of things, and the LAN side of things is being profitable fine. Okay, but it's not like oh shit, we're all driving Ferraris. The LAN side is good. It makes money, and don't know how much, you know, I don't ask, but it's a side of the business that works. Now, a lot of people actually think that the LAN side of things supports the eSports side of things within the company, and that's not actually true, as far as I can tell, because everything from the eSports side of things is paid for via the eSports sponsors. So if any tournament happens or anything happens, it's already paid for. So DreamHack will never do something where it's at a loss or a death, you know, they lose money. So if there's a Quake tournament, it's got Kingston sponsoring it. If they're doing the Swedish SM, Swedish Masters, which is a new concept for them, it's, you know, it's sponsored by Telia. You know, and it's covered. So the employees that work, and there's only 9 of them, I believe, at DreamHack, the employees that work might get paid throughout the year from the LAN as well as the eSports side of things, but the eSports run solely off eSports, and the LAN runs solely off LAN. So a lot of people say that it's like the LAN supports what they do in eSports and why they do it so well. Not true. You know, so in my opinion, not true. I'm sure Houseborn will look at this and go, you're wrong. But from what I've seen within the company and looking at all the, you know, how much things, what are happening and what they're doing. So basically, DreamHack have kept everything small and grown naturally in the way that they have not overextended themselves. And they've also been smart enough to focus on being good at production and entertainment. And when I say image, I don't necessarily mean how cool you are. I said it a lot, but I more mean the entertainment side of the industry, you know, making sure that there's little downtime. That if you're going to play music when Forzane wins, it's going to be cool. But obviously, you need a license in Sweden to do that, which they have. So, yeah, they prepare for a lot and they do great. And they're still my favorite company because they're so small, they're so diverse, and everyone listens to everybody. Now, DreamHack, in my opinion, have done some of the best events last year and are going to do this year. And I look at their company and I say they're 9 full-time employees. I'm going to take a guess and I'm going to say there's about 50 full-time employees at MLG.
Ballpark, yeah. It's around that number. I don't know the official number, but...
Yeah. So I think it's overly impressive that with 9 full-time employees, some of them you will never see working at events apart from just doing little things because they're either salesmen and stuff, that they've been able to pull off such an amazing year and will do so again. And part of it is that, you know, there's so many volunteers, but I really can't fault DreamHack. The only thing I can fault DreamHack 4 is, I don't know, it's hard. It's maybe, I honestly, when I found them and got to work with them and continued to work with them, it was very hard for me to find anything that they couldn't do. Okay, the one thing that DreamHack doesn't do, and they don't want to do, and they have blind comms.
Oh, sorry, repeat
DreamHack
that.
Do not do online comms.
You lagged on Skype, okay. Sorry. I just want to make sure they didn't think I edited that out or anything.
Oh, yeah. The one thing that DreamHack hasn't succeeded with and don't do that I can fault them for, but they don't need to do it because you don't need to have the same product as everyone else, is that they don't do online content. They don't do weekly content. You know, they don't do, like, NASL stuff. They just do these big events and big LANs and big shows. And in all fairness, I think that's great for me, because it's allowed a gap in the market for me to open up the good studio and do content on a weekly basis. So thank you, DreamHack. But I think they tried doing it before and failed at it. So they're not successful at everything they do, but there's a little saying in DreamHack. It's like, I can't remember exactly what it is. Hopefully I get it right. Robert says it's like, it's okay to do the wrong thing right, but never to do the right thing wrong. So DreamHack are okay that they know they're doing a product and they don't necessarily know if it's the right thing to do for the industry and eSports, but as long as they do it right, it's fine. And they really do great. So they're going nowhere, DreamHack. And DreamHack, you know, ESL's had investment. ESL's probably had private investment as well. MLG's had investment. IPL has been backed. You know, NASL's had investment. DreamHack, no investment.
And then finally over in Korea, and kind of got to lump this together because OGN hasn't been out there so much in the StarCraft II sphere, but GSL definitely has been, so GSL.
Yeah, GSL's, I like Mr. Che. He's awesome. He used to commentate World of Warcraft. Do you know that about him?
I did not.
You know when the Koreans did that World of Warcraft?
Oh, yeah. No, you're right. That's right.
Mr. Che was the fucking Korean commentator for it.
Wow.
Yeah. You didn't know that?
I didn't. I remember him casting that, but I totally forgot that it was him actually doing it. So, World of Warcraft, man. It's taken over.
Yeah, there was two English. Yeah. There was two Americans that commentated the English stream, but he was doing the Korean stream. So, Mr. Che. He's quite young as well, actually, to be running that company, but that's good. I guess. GOM TV, doing really well. Like what they do. Like their image. Don't like their player. But in general, I just like what's going on with their product over there. Quite scared for them now because Kesper are coming in and Kesper have a lot more suits. And suits do make a big difference in esports, unfortunately. And I feel that Kesper are going to strong arm the competition away. So I feel that people who like GOM TV and, you know, like GSL should really support them. More, but I think they've got a good starting foot, you know, a good foot forward, sorry, so to speak, over Casper. So, yeah, GSL haven't done anything that looks to me to be over the top financially risky, and they've always as well provided a better experience as we've gone down the road. So I really can't say much about them apart from I know a lot of people enjoy their content, and I enjoy it too actually when I watch it. It's a really nice production. I wish they'd get rid of the player though and go on Twitch TV or something, because that the player is apparently more popular in Korea.
Yeah, it's huge. Like,
yeah, people love that player because you get all types of channels on it and stuff.
Yeah.
And I hate it. What? I swear it lacked our internet when Apollo's watching it every fucking morning.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Yeah. Well, that kind of rounds up the league thoughts. Did you happen to catch the CBSI press release that came out the other day?
Yeah, where they announced that they're doing stuff with...
Yeah, are you part of the 96%? Too good?
What's the 96%? Yeah, I don't know.
They said that they own 96% of the...
Basically, I'm not bothered that CBS want to talk whatever they want to talk in the mainstream, right? Doesn't bother me, because CBS are so big of a fucking company. Let them say what the fuck they want, because they're going to make a bigger impact than anyone else that we have already in esports, all right? So if they want to take credit for, like, how big or what's going to happen and say that this is amazing and they're doing amazing things and people should talk to them, go fucking talk to CBS Interactive, because they will do huge for us. And it's not a problem that they, you know, said, like, they're serving DreamHack and all this other stuff, because DreamHack will never have the connections that CBS Interactive have to make something really big happen. It's good, though, if CBS Interactive would talk to DreamHack and get some sort of partnership there, but I'm sure they'll be introduced via Twitch TV, because that was where the first contract actually happened. Twitch TV, the reason, just to go on to the CBS, the reason I joined Twitch TV was not only because of the community support, is because I've always fight for the little guy normally, and this time I just felt like with a company that has this much opportunity, I want to be involved with the big guy. And Twitch TV... The main difference we see them growing over Own3D is not necessarily always because of the product or the platform or the chat or the little differences between the two. It's also because Twitch TV are big enough as a company to get notice on Forbes and to get written about and to be a big press story. Own3D aren't really that story. And I think that's also similar to where CBS are coming into our industry. They're so big as a company, like Twitch TV was so big as a company, they basically got us CBS Interactive. That was Twitch TV. Right? They worked on that for a fucking long time. I know Kevin did. Yeah. And CBS Interactive are in esports space. So Twitch TV, because they were big, and they were big globally, that they got more viewers and we supporting them, they got CBS. And then from CBS, we're going to see the next level of shit happen as well. So if CBS were to say they're fucking doing great things, I don't give a fuck, as long as it makes esports bigger, because, if anyone's got an ego of, oh no, we built this industry or we've been around for such a long time, it's worth just being like, fuck it, small fish, let them do something brilliant, Because at the end of the day, the people that are reading the CBS Interactive press releases aren't your average Joes. It's us, because we're linked to them. And then it's, business developers from other companies looking for opportunities. And that one press release, if it makes them sound great and the people to work with, yeah, go fucking work with them, because we're all going to benefit at the end of the day.
All right. Well, the final questions here are pretty broad, kind of covering everything. Basically ending this interview, what's the one thing that you are most happy with in everything that you've done in esports?
Probably providing as many jobs as I have to different people, and also inspiring, hopefully, people to want to join the industry. I had someone take my advice recently. He said, how do I get a job in esports? I said, what you need to do is you need to be at every LAN. If people see you there, they might not even know what you do, but they'll be like, he's everywhere. He's got to be doing something good. So he actually took his own money and he went to all these lands and he was a good worker and he was a very nice person and people buy people. And eventually he got to quit his job in London, which he didn't enjoy, which was like, not a banking job. It was like a business analyst job, actually. And now he's moving to Singapore, where he's going to work with Razer full time as a team manager.
That's awesome.
And so the thing is like, I think I provided probably some of the most networking, the most opportunities, and the most jobs This, you know, not jobs as in like jobs as if I've employed the most people. Obviously, people like ESL and the big companies have done that. But in terms of connecting people with the right people to work with, and I really feel happy if I've inspired people to watch more, even if it's just watch more. It doesn't have to be work in the industry. It's, you know, just inspire people to enjoy more esports and hopefully, you know, want to be a part of it, want to be a pro gamer or work or even a volunteer or do some content. So I just hope that if I was most proud of what I've done, it's kind of just fly the flag the best I can outside of my persona and all the crazy shit I do. You know, behind that, there's someone actually who doesn't want this industry to go anywhere apart from up. So, yeah.
What's the one thing, if you could flick a switch and it would change right then, right now in esports, what would that be?
Flick a switch and it would change in esports. Just give me an example.
I mean, what, like, basically, I'm just getting at, what's the biggest problem in your eyes right now with the industry?
Biggest problem. I don't think we have that many problems right now. The viewing numbers are good. Financially, we're looking a lot better. We're attracting more mainstream media than we ever have done before. Players are on good salaries. Teams are reputable, and they've been established for a while. There's only a few of them that fuck up, like Eclipsia or whatever it is. So there's not really any big problems. Prize money is being paid out. I don't see any big problem. There's small things that are needed that could help, but I don't think there's anything that would, if I change or flip a switch on, would change the way esports would grow. I think we're actually on a really good path right now, and we just need to continue doing well, you know, just making sure we appease sponsors and, you know, do the right things for the community and treat, you know, players and teams and event organizers fine. If I had any wishes, I would wish that we would be even more, not mainstream, but have mainstream sponsors, a lot more mainstream sponsors. I think maybe that's like where we, but we're all, that's already starting to happen. So, but a lot more mainstream sponsors would be good. But it already seems to be happening. It's just, you know, so maybe I could only ask things to happen quicker because we're in the right direction.
All right. And finally, the last thing, possibly the best thing. What is your craziest esports story? It could be a party. It could be something that someone did. Whatever you want, man.
Dude, my stories, I'm not going to be able to share them. I know it's real talk, but literally, people wouldn't even say this in private to other people. Like, you wouldn't even tell these kind of stories to a mate because you know the person that you're talking about. Even if your mate didn't know that guy, it's not a story that you want to tell. Rather than give you a story to boycott it, right, to distract you from the story.
Uh-oh. I think he's going to get kittens. I think the kittens are coming. That or he's putting something on. Let's just wait. Hope it's the kittens.
All right. I don't have a story. Yeah? But I've got a kitten.
There you go, kitten. Guys.
You're on Real Talk. Look up there. What are you doing? You scared?
He doesn't like looking at himself. All right, man.
He's on the keyboard now, typing away.
James, thank you so much for coming on. I think it's almost 3 hours now. Do you have any final things that you want to say or get out?
No, not really. No. Not really. I think I spoke way too long. I'm late for going out. I'm going to be in so much trouble with lots of different people that I can't mention. But yeah, basically, I love esports. I'll continue to do it. If you like what I do, then follow me. If you don't like what I do, then don't. And find something you enjoy doing and keep doing it. And you get a lot more out of life with doing things you love and having a huge amount of dedication. Talent and skill, you know, is only a small percent. So just do what you enjoy. That's how I've got here. I've quit every job I didn't like, and I've only done things I like. And I'm very happy with where I am. Kidden, what are you doing? What are you doing, Kidden? What are you doing? She's behind. She's trying to... Why? Where are you? What are you trying to do? She's trying to drink out of the cup. She's so cute. This is the bravest kitten out of all of them. The other kittens aren't as brave as her, but she's like the adventurer. She...
Real quick, while this is going on, where can people check out your shows over at the Good Studio?
Oh, you broke up.
Oh, I was saying... You still good? Can you hear me?
Yeah. I can't hear you. I'm just going to give you a kitten. I can't hear you, JP. Yeah, you can hear me. You can check us out at the Good Studio. It's on Twitch TV. And we've got fucking kittens that are going to restart the router. Adventure kitten is adventurous.
All right, guys.
I'm just going to fucking leave now. Wasting my time and everyone else's. If you watch the end of this, you're crazy. And I'm going to save the kitten. See ya.
All right, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Again, thanks to James for coming on. Real talk. I'm out. We'll figure out who the next guest is going to be. I will tweet about it over at twitter.com/MeJP. We'll see you guys later. Peace.